Welcome to day four of competition at the cycling track here at Tokyo 2020. The Itsu Velodrome is the venue once again. We've had four gold medals decided thus far in 3 days of thrilling racing. World records been shattered in the men's and women's team pursuit and the women's team sprint. Italy, Germany, the Netherlands and China have collected gold medals. Today there are two more on offer, the women's Kirin and the exciting men's Omnium. While the watts will also be delivered as the men's sprint rounds continue. For the last 4 years, we've had the Omnium changing format, and it all takes place in one day, and it opens up today's program with a scratch race first up. The women's Kirin goes through to the semi-finals and then the medal races as well. The Omnium continues at periods through the day, and it'll culminate in the points race, which is the final event in the Omnium to determine the gold medalist. It's an enthralling day again as we look down over the pit areas with the teams and riders preparing those who are in action today, warming up and preparing for the day's riding. Well, the Omnium is the big on the program today, and certainly we are in for some enthralling racing. It has changed format. In Rio in 2016, there were six events in the Omnium, and it took place over 2 days. Now it is taking place in one day with four events. It was introduced in the Olympic program in 2012. Lasse Norman Hansen won in London. He's not taking part this year, but he does have a silver medal in the team pursuit to his name. And Elia Viviani was the gold medal in Rio. He is back here, plus the world champions from the last four world championships, including the defending world champion, Benjamin Thomas. He's a two-time champion. Campbell Stewart is here. And Simon Chaznok, who won in 2018, is also here. So it is a jam-packed race with all the best in the world on the start line. And a Japanese rider as well for the home crowd to cheer on their way as Aya Hashimoto will be on the start line. The first event is the scratch race, a mass start race. First to the finish, the winner. Fairly simple, 10 kilometers, that's 40 laps of the track. Then it's the tempo race, which is new to the Omnium in this cycle. 10 kilometers, 40 laps. After the first five laps, the winner of each lap earns a point. Lapping the field earns 20 points. The winner of the race gets the one who gets the most points. The elimination race, every two laps, the last place cyclist is eliminated. And then the points race, a 25 kilometer, 100 lap points race. Points earned for sprints every 10 laps, with double points for final sprint and for lapping the field. And that should determine the gold medalist. We'll wait and see. It's enthralling. It's so exciting to have all these riders warming up. They've had a look through the field there. And we've got riders who have won world championships. We've got riders riding their first big Omnium here today. There is Japan's hope, Hashimoto. And sitting alongside me, Rochelle Gilmore's warming up for a few hours of really fantastic track racing.
Gerald, I'm already excited about what's going on out there. Elia Viviani, the big name in the Omnium. Of course, the favourite man of the moment from France, but it's going to be a hotly contested, and there he is, a hotly contested Omnium, and very exciting. What I like about the new format is that from the start of racing, on the same day, you get to see who wins the gold medal. So we can be excited to see these riders race four events, and then they'll, with the last event being the points race, we'll see the gold medal awarded to the most consistent rider over the day.
Who does it suit? I mean, endurance rider, sprint rider. I mean, Viviani, we know, is a world-class sprinter. He's got 81 races, so one in under his belt. Who does it suit?
Well, it definitely means you have to have more endurance now that it's in one day. They only have 25 to 40 minutes between events. They need to be able to recover very well. But from the sprint side of it, they still need to be fast because that's where all the results and the points come from. So it has made it, I think, more demanding on the athletes putting the four events in the one day. But, the pure sprinters, I think it's just too heavy a program.
Yeah, Mark Cavendish was a silver medalist in Rio in 2016. He's not here. Fernando Gaviria won the last world championship that was staged over 2 days and six events. That's Matthew Walls, who was a bronze medalist at the world championships last year, behind Benjamin Thomas and the other man who's a real contender here, Jan-Willem van Schip from the Netherlands, silver medalist at the World Championships in Berlin. There is the world champion, Benjamin Thomas, two-time world champion. And he did, at 2020's World Championships on his way to that title, win the scratch race. Campbell Stewart, the world champion as well. He was the world champion in 2019. Clinched that in the points race. Here's Jan-Willem van Schip. Silver medalist twice in a row in the world championship. Roger Kluger, the man who's done a lot of work on the road this year, the German. All the way down this field of world-class riders. Right at the back on this little bit is Mark Downey from Ireland. Johanni Karoliak, the Scratch Ace World Champion from 2020. There is the World Champion from 2018. Szczesnik from Poland. So the field split on either side of the track.
Yeah, so the Scratch Race being 40 laps, 10 kilometres. A little bit shorter for a Scratch Race than they'd see at a World Championship or a World Cup. Nations Cup, but the reason for that is that they've got four more events to cover today.
The first event in the four-event Omnium in the men's competition here at Issus Velodrome is underway, and we've got 20 riders on the track. And this first event is the Scratch Race, 40 laps, 10 kilometers, and it's a fairly simple race because it's first across the line wins. And that winner will get 40 points all the way down. There is the gun. They're on their way.
Yeah, so they had one lap neutral just to sort themselves out in positioning. Scratch Race is one of the most easiest races to describe of the Omnium. 40 laps, 10 kilometres, first across the line wins. And then they'll be awarded with 40 points for the winner and the same for the other two events to follow, the tempo race and elimination. And then the points race from the points race are just added on to their tally. So this is the first event, Scratch Race, with so many hot contenders to win this first event.
Yeah, I think let's just take a time to go through the field here because Elia Viviani is the Olympic champion and he was ninth at the World Championships last year, but he peaks for the Olympics and no doubt feeding off the Italians' sensational win in the team pursuit yesterday in a world record time. Niklas Larsen represents Denmark. No less than Norman Hansen in this event, the 2012 World Olympic champion. Campbell Stewart is here, the New Zealander and the world champion from a couple of years ago. Jan-Willem van Schip, silver medalist to last year. Roger Kluger from Germany, the 35-year-old two-time Madison world champion, is in the field. Bronze medalist, at least fourth at the World Championship last year. Representing the United States, Gavin Hoover, seventh at the World Championships last year. Thierry Schrier from Switzerland, a 28-year-old, and then the Asian Omnium champion from a couple of years ago, Artyom Zakharov, in the field, as well as Kenny de Ketler, a six-day specialist representing Belgium, the 36-year-old, and Mark Downey from Ireland, the 25-year-old, in his first Olympic experience. Matthew Walls, bronze medalist from Great Britain, he represents them. France's Benjamin Thomas, great hope for France. World champion and looking for an Olympic title today. Sam Welsford, the 2019 Scratch Race world champion, is in the field. Hashimoto Aya from Japan, the Asian Omnium champion, current Asian champion, is there. Albert Torres Bartello as well. Well, we're already seeing a rider about to be caught, and that's the South African David Maria is under pressure. He'll swing up high, and he will be passed by the leader, Szczesnik.
You just heard again, gun. Which causes some confusion, but I actually think it was a tyre blowing out in the middle of the track. They can be extremely, extremely loud. So the riders are a bit confused there, but the leaders of the race.
Ah. Well, so I was running through the field. The leaders of the race are David Maria and the Polish former world champion, Szymon Szczesnik.
Yeah, fantastic effort from the South African. Came into this event shaking in his boots, against all these big names, but he's certainly doing something about it.
Well, it's the way to go about it. He's the African champion, and get out there and be bold and brave, and that's exactly what he's doing.
Yeah, if they were able to take a lap, these two riders, then they would be still be considered the leaders of the race. So if they don't really back themselves in a sprint in the finish with the fast man, they try to take a lap, which really puts them in a strong position.
Well, they're working here now.
The race is so fast that I think it'll be hard for any riders to take a lap.
Yeah, the quality of the field, there is such a quality in this field.
Orange's tied legs out in front now.
Yeah, slowly but surely they're closing in and they're rolling up. And that little attack is over. Bold, though, it is nice and early, having a dash off the front.
Oh, Roger Kluger taking some height on the track from Germany. He's got a lot of experience. When riders are taking height on the track, it could mean that they're getting wound up for an attack. I'm just trying to look at the other riders and see what's going on.
Spain's Albert Torres goes to the front with Thomas on his wheel, but not for long.
The Australian Sam Wells, but he swings straight up the track, so he's not willing to pick up the pace. He just wants to wait for a sprint. One of the faster men slips back in there about 10th position. That's Viviani on the front. He swings up early too, as does the rider from Denmark.
Yeah, no one's prepared now to have a dash off the front. It's, they're spending very little time. Jan Willem van Schip now, the Dutchman, goes to the front with 23 laps remaining.
Yeah, it's a pretty fast race, given it's 40 laps of the velodrome, it's 10Ks, but it's all done and done, dusted pretty quickly with 22 laps to go.
Downey now, not for long. Viviani nicely positioned in that smartly bedecked helmet, just marking Mark Walls.
Yeah, from Great Britain, you can see that there's some riders just trying to pick up the pace, but most of the riders swinging straight off at second and third wheel, which indicates they're waiting for a sprint. Denmark puts the pressure down now.
Nicholas Larsen's having a go.
Nicholas Larsen really trying to break up that group from the front. He's got Sam Welsford trying to close the gap. Now Sam Welsford continues on with that attack, but he swings up early, and as does the rest of the bunch. Maybe the man from Spain, he wants to keep it going, and this is good for Denmark as well. The pace is really on.
Well, Torres is the man on the front there for a moment for Spain. He won the scratch race at the World Champs in 2019, so he knows what he's about here. His Walls goes to the front momentarily.
Yeah, and he swings up. Viviani swings up on the wheel, so Viviani not willing to do any work.
Here goes Nicholas Larsen, though, the Dane, and he's found himself a bit of a gap now. Jan Willem van Schip is giving chase, but Larsen's made a bit of a gap here.
That's what Larsen wanted to do. He really wanted the pressure to be high so they get fatigued legs and then hit them again. And this is his chance. While the race is really just floating around the top of the track, he can put more time into them. He's committed to this, Nicholas Larsen from Denmark.
One of the few in this field who did the men's team pursuit. Larsen was part of the Danish team that took the silver medal there. That gap is being held, and now Benjamin Thomas, Jan Willem van Schip give chase, as does Artem Zakharov from Kazakhstan.
Yeah, well, the Frenchman, he is the top favourite. So he's done the big work there. He's got the rider from Netherlands, Van Schip, right with him to help him with the work. This could be a good trio. As the peloton keeps swinging up behind, nobody willing to do the chase. Roger Kluger comes to the front now to help with the chase. But it's a dangerous breakaway.
Well, they're together now. Thomas goes. Van Schip, as well as Larsen, still in there. And Zakharov.
And Thomas looking very, very strong. Van Schip coming through now, and Thomas jumps onto third wheel, and we have Larsen.
Well, Thomas laid the foundation for his world championship win last year in Berlin by winning the scratch race first up.
Matthew Walls trying to come across.
Quality's rising. Here comes Walls joining that group of five on the front. And the early pace setter is under pressure now.
we have to imagine that from this group, Thomas is one of the faster riders. It's a South African rider. David Marie, he tries to get back on after losing a lap, but the pace is just too high. Great to see him out there putting in a good effort, and he'll swing up again and wait for the bunch.
Meanwhile, up front, it's Larsen, Thomas, Van Skip, Walls, and Zakharov. With just nine laps remaining, it's been blisteringly fast. This is the lead group. The chase group still swinging up off the track.
No one from the chase group really wanting to dedicate to this chase. But the leaders are dedicated to getting away and taking those points. So Larsen on the front from Denmark. It's Benjamin Thomas from France that looks like the strongest rider. This every time he comes through, the rider on the wheel loses it.
This is going to be a really, really big group, this dangerous group, because you've got the gold and silver medalist and the bronze medalist from last year's World Championship in this group of five.
Well, it looks like they might. With six laps to go, will they make the connection? I don't think it really matters now for the peloton. They're racing for the minor points. Yes, and the lead group are now going to make the catch.
That lead group of five have made the catch.
So they are now the leaders of the race.
With four laps remaining.
You hear a lot of whistles, the coaches in the middle, they whistle really loud when there's an attack coming and the riders have to pay attention. But you have to keep an eye on the Frenchman, the rider from Netherlands, Great Britain, Denmark and Kazakhstan. They are the riders that are leading this race in this peloton, so they'll be sprinting it out against each other. And in fact, they should be sprinting it out a lap earlier than the bunch. However, the bunch may sprint first. Two laps to go for the bunch.
2-1 is now the pace has been wound up.
And it's Sam Wellsford from Australia, the minor placing, sixth place with the Kiwi behind him.
Remember their points for all the positions, but Matthew Walls is in there for Great Britain.
And Campbell Stewart, a great ride there as well.
And Nicholas Larsen rolling in a long way down. He'd done his work early by helping him initiate the attack and take the lap. And Walls it is who is credited with taking the win there for Great Britain. Well, Larsen.
They sprinted a lap early with the peloton. Benjamin Thomas takes second place. And Larsen in third. Changing. The results are changing, so don't take those as official results.
Yeah. They're starting to come through. Walls, Thomas, Jan-Willem van Schip, Artyom Zakharov, Nicholas Larsen. Those are the five who are in the break, and they finished in that order, which puts Walls on 40 points, Thomas on 38, Van Skip 36, Zakharov 34, and Larsen 32. And all the way down to David Marie in 20th place on 2 points.
So a great start from the favourite, Benjamin Thomas, but that was the winner of the scratch race from Great Britain, Matthew Walls. Great start to the Omnium. They've got three events to go. That was the first of the four. The scratch race has been completed. Matthew Walls, Benjamin Thomas from France. He's the big favourite. And Van Schip, the strong man.
Well, there you are, the medalists in the World Championships a year ago. Van Schip takes third place. He was second at the World Champs. So the form book is holding up after the first race in the Omnium, with Walls, Thomas and Van Skip first, second and third, leading the Omnium after the first event. Zakharov, who was in that break, initiated by this man, the Dane, Nicholas Larsen. And he didn't get involved in the sprint. He knew they could fight it out. He was going to be in fifth place, and that was good enough for him at this stage, 32 points.
Yeah, I think all the riders finishing in the top five or six will be very happy with their performances. That's the first of the bunch, Sam Wellsford crossing the line from Australia. And then Campbell Stewart from New Zealand in second place. and a great ride from Hashimoto, the Japanese rider, to come in eighth place.
Just saw Walls there crossing in that second group. There's Thomas, and then Van Skip. So it's a busy place, the Omnium track, in the bunch races.
Yeah, sometimes very confusing, especially that finish where we had the lapped riders sprinting with the main peloton. The riders who had taken a lap, they finished the race on the same lap as the main bunch.
And Willem van Skip is nicely positioned after round one in the Omnium. So the men's Omnium, Matthew Walls, Benjamin Thomas and Willem van Skip, Zakharov Larsen, Welsford, Stuart Aya Skier and Gavin Hoover from the United States, De Ketteler, the veteran from Belgium, Roger Kluger, Viviani, the defending champion. He's got work to do later on. Sajnok, former world champion, likewise, was in the early break.
Yeah, there's the results from the men's Omnium. Interesting thing about the Omnium is that the big name riders like Ella Viviani and Roger Kluger, they're so heavily marked that when they try to go in a breakaway, that the whole peloton chases. So we see Elio Viviani finished in 13th position in the scratch race, but he did rise to the occasion in Rio when he was heavily marked, so he's a rider to keep an eye on.
Our next event is the men's sprint last eight finals, and this promises to be another enthralling race, set of races, because we've got six of them. Hoogeland against Awang, Lavrais and the world champion against Sarom. Jack Carlin from Great Britain's been outstanding against young Sebastian Vigier from France. World record holder Nicholas Paul against the local favorite Yuta Wakimoto. Dimitri, the former world champion, against the defending champion Jason Kenyon. Max Levy against Sam Webster. Winner of each of these heats qualifies to the quarterfinals. The losers go to the last eight repechage round.
Wang is a small rider from Malaysia. The race has started, and he's up against Jeffrey Hoogland, the big Dutchman, who's relatively more powerful, faster, but Awang is an exciting rider, and he can come off a wheel pretty quick as well. So Awang would have studied every move of Hoogland's heats up until this point, and he's trying to put pressure on Hoogland, the Dutchman, to come to the front. And he'll keep doing this until he tries to get himself in the back position behind. He knows he can come off a wheel very quick. The skills of these riders are absolutely amazing. And now we'll see Awang pedal backwards, just trying to go faster than slower to push Hoogland in front. He may have just decided that's not going to be possible now.
Diving down goes Hoogland, still looking. Awang starting to wind it up. He's now where he wants to be. And they wind it up to take the bell now with Jeffrey Hoogland leading Awang.
Awang will give a little bit of space here and then he'll run at the wheel as hard as he possibly can. Here he comes.
Can he get past the big, strong Dutchman who's looked so comfortable in all his rounds so far? And again, he wins with relative ease, Jeffrey Hoogland. He's only raced three times and he's now into the quarterfinals direct. Awang will have to go to the repechage round once again.
So if you're going to come and try to come off the wheel of any man, I think this would be the hardest man's wheel to come off. He's so solid and strong on the bike. So taking their last big, deep breaths before they come off the start line. Here's Awang trying to come up the boards and force Hoogland to the front. But Hoogland has perfect skills as well. And he didn't make any mistakes. Awang trying to come off the wheel in the last corner, but Hoogland just too strong and solid on the bike. Shake of the hands there.
A sort of fist pump. So Wang, who's had to race two more races than Hoogland, will have to do again as he goes to the repechage rounds. Our next event, the second heat of the last eight in the men's sprint. This is Harry Lebrezen, the Dutch world champion. So powerful and has been in great form. They already have an Olympic gold medal in the men's sprint. And this is his opponent, second of the Malaysians, Muhammad Shah Firas Saharom.
Well, I think we're going to see a very similar race here. This big, powerful Dutchman against the smaller rider from Malaysia.
Second heat underway in the last eight of the men's sprint. Harry Lebrezen, the world champion from the Netherlands, against Muhammad Shah Firas Saharom.
Lebrezen, the Dutchman at the back, he comes from a BMX background and he had to switch over because of injuries, shoulder injuries in BMX, so it's just too much impact. But the Malaysian Saharom, he is taking it out from the front.
Lebrezen, that's where he wants to be right now.
He's swinging up the track to try and put pressure on Saharom to pick up the speed and put pressure on his legs. That's why they take height on the bank. It puts pressure on the rider in front to start working harder. And Lebrezen's doing a fantastic job.
He's got so much power, the Dutchman, as he goes to the bell and takes the lead now. To power off the bend on that back straight. He's got a big lead now. Saharom is not going to get past this wheel, that's for sure. Harry Lebrezen, the world champion, is in imperious form here in Tokyo. So composed, so clean.
Yeah, and the Dutch team have looked that way right from the start of competition, just really in control, solid on the bike, very calm. They're getting their tactics right, but they've got the power and the speed that they have at the moment. The men from the Netherlands, is unbelievable.
Got their sprint team and their sprint tactics so well dialed. Bryson and Hoogeland.
Lebrezen with his power there, given he has shoulder injuries, he's had 30 dislocations of his shoulder, and to be able to put that much force through them, it's quite remarkable.
Confirming the results of heat two in the last eight, the men's sprint, Harry Lebrezen getting the better of Muhammad Saharom of Malaysia. The third heat features Great Britain's Jack Carlin and Frenchman Sebastian Vigier. Carlin got past Nathan Hart and Saharom in the last 16, Hart in the last 32. And Vigier had to go the long way round. Vigier is going to have to work hard here against Jack Carlin, has shown some good form.
Yeah, absolutely. Carlin, the man to beat in this round. What can Vigier do? So the white powder on the hands as they roll off the start line.
Vigier, the Frenchman on the front. Jack Carlin, second rider here in heat three of the last eight of the men's sprint.
You can see the concentration. The sprint is such a tactical race. Vigier just keeping an eye on Carlin. He's obviously got the idea of what tactic he wants to use, but Jack Carlin, he can't be intimidated. So it looks like the Frenchman is trying to force Carlin to the front.
Looking over his shoulder all the while, winding it up now is Vigier. Have a proud history producing great men's sprinters.
Extremely good tactics from Carlin. It really forces Vigier into a vulnerable position. Makes him go long. Now they'll start the sprint proper. One lap to go. Vigier just trying very, very hard to hold off Collin, but Collin's going to come home fast.
And he is. Jack Collin now gets past Vigier, but he could be fighting the Frenchman. It's going to be very close, but in the end, Collin rolls away and powers to victory for Great Britain. And through to the quarterfinals, Jack Collin.
Such a mental game out there with the sprinters. You really have to keep your heart rate under control, stay relaxed and be confident in what you're doing. And the confidence comes from studying your opponents, finding their weak points, working out how to beat them. But Jack Collin of Great Britain, he is through now to the next round, as Vigier did all he could.
Looks across, another race done, ticks that one off.
Yeah, we've spoken about before, the men's sprint can be very, very demanding. They have to keep backing up. So it's a sprint race, but you need to have the endurance to keep backing up, sprint after sprint.
Heat four in the men's sprint, last eight. The man who owns the fastest time in the sprint at the moment in the world, Nicholas Paul from Trinidad and Tobago, and he's up against Akimoto Yuta from Japan. What a big moment this is.
No doubt there will be a lot of nerves racing against what we could say is the fastest man in the world at the moment from Trinidad and Tobago. You see, rolling up to the line, Nicholas Paul.
He's gone straight through Nicholas Paul, and he's beaten Matt Richardson and Muhammad Wang. Whilst Wakimoto got past Kevin Quintero, then lost to Jason Kenny and went to the repechage rounds and got past Stefan Buttiger, the former world champion. Underway is heat number four in the men's sprint, last eight. Nicholas Paul, the bottom of the track from Trinidad and Tobago, against Wakimoto Yuta from Japan.
Well, what can Wakimoto do? He would have had to think this one through many times.
The home crowd have got their eyes fixed on this one.
They both want to sprint long. They want to try to use endurance. Wakimoto is really, really pushing Nicholas Paul.
Very, very skilled Kieran Ryder is Wakimoto Yuta. Not afraid to get shoulder to shoulder. Here goes Nicholas Paul of Trinidad and Tobago from the front. Now, can he bring it home? He's got tremendous power. He is the world record holder, and he proves it again here in Tokyo. Too much power for the Japanese rider. Trinidad and Tobago's Nicholas Paul wins, and it goes directly through to the quarterfinals.
Well, I can tell you one thing, Nicholas Paul would not have been expecting to have to work that hard for that long in that race. So a great tactic from Wakimoto. He tried to take him long and put him under pressure, not let him use his raw power and speed. It would have been fantastic if Wakimoto was doing that from the inside. He may have had a chance. See how much fatigue it's taken out of the rider from Trinidad and Tobago, Nicholas Paul. He had to work really hard. Coach in the corner telling him to wipe off the speed already before he gets to the finish line and save his legs.
So Nicholas Paul, a comfortable winner, and Wakimoto Yuta has to go through to the repechage round of the sprint. There's so many repechage rounds, so riders have to work really hard if they lose early. It pays to keep winning, because Nicholas Paul has only had three races in his legs now. Our fifth heat in the last eight of the men's sprint. Former world champion Denis Dmitriev against the current Olympic champion, a two-time world champion, Jason Kenny. This is a race to savor.
This will be a fantastic one. Two very, very experienced riders on the start line.
Well, Kenny got past Awang and Akimoto. Dmitriev seemed to go a little bit, he got past Ryan Hillel. So Denis Dmitriev goes to the front in this fifth heat in the men's last eight of the sprint with Jason Kenny of Great Britain, the defending champion, on his wheel.
Well, we've seen Kenny use his experience to get to this point, lacking a tiny bit of speed, but maybe just racing his way in throughout this competition. He's been quite confident and comfortable with the wins that he's had, but just missing that top-end speed that might be coming in the final days of the sprint now. But he doesn't often make a tactical error. Jason Kenny's riding from the back. Dmitriev keeping an eye on him. They will both know each other very, very well.
Two of the most experienced racers in the game, these two.
So Jason Kenny coming now. He wants to take the lead early. Will he get around? He's taken the long way. No, he's just done that to force pressure.
Dmitriev responded. So Dmitriev, Kenny now on the outside. Dmitriev out the saddle on that back straight. Kenny goes on the outside, tries to pull him back in. It's going to be very close. Jason Kenny's going to have to work really hard to win this. He won't. A win for Denis Dmitriev of the Russian Olympic Committee over the defending champion, Jason Kenny.
Well, he certainly did everything right tactically, and so did Jason Kenny, but the tactics he's used in the past are not quite working without that maximum speed that we've seen in his legs before. It's just not there yet at the Tokyo Olympics. So don't count him out. He still has a chance to come through with Repecharge. Well, there we see the tactic. He wanted to lay off the wheel and come at him. But Dmitriev in the final straight, he didn't die. He just powered on, picking up the speed to take the win. And that was a significant win for this championship.
That really is. So Jason Kenny, if he is to defend his title, he's going to have to go the long way round and really, really produce some results here. It is fourth Olympic Games. Max Levy is next on the track against Sam Webster. So Levy, a silver medalist in the Kirin in his time, and a man who's got so much experience, as has Sam Webster. Winner goes through to the quarterfinals direct. Thanks to the repechage rounds. Sam Webster of New Zealand and Max Levy of Germany on the track in the final heat of the last eight in the men's sprint.
Well, Levy picking up the pace at the back. He wants to put pressure on Webster. And he's done that. And he's done exactly what he wanted to do. Max Levy and Sam Webster. Max Levy at the back for Germany, Sam Webster at the front for New Zealand. It looks like Levy has got this tactically in hand, but will he have the power to come over Sam Webster? That's the big question. One lap to go, the race is on.
Bell and Webster's trying to hold on the front. Levy's winding it up now. He's got off the wheel and he's going over the top. Can he get past him on the bend here? Levy, does he have enough power? He does. The German will take the win.
Yeah, the tactics were exactly what Levy wanted in that race. He just had to rely on his brute strength and power to come over Sam Webster in the finish straight.
Yeah, it means a lot to Max Levy. He's through directly to the quarterfinals, the big powerful German.
We see the replay just cleaning the tyres, making sure there's nothing on them. They're not slippery if they have to do a track stand at the top of the track. Sam Webster fighting really, really hard, but Max Levy just too strong and powerful in the home straight. Takes the win and goes straight through to the quarterfinals, and he is happy about that.
Yeah, the workload, he was in the sprint, team sprint as well, so the workload high for these sprinters. They've got, neither most of them are doing the Kirin as well. So you don't have to go through the repechage rounds. It does make it a lot more comfortable.
It has always been something that I admire from the sprinters, how hard they actually work. We think they only race a couple of laps, but to back up like they do after maximum efforts, they have so much lactic acid in their legs to keep them rolling between events on the rollers.
So through to the quarterfinals, Jeffrey Hooger and Harry Labraez, Sir Jack Carl and Nicholas Paul, Denis Dimitriev and Max Levy, the remaining riders through to the repechage round. Our next event at the Itzu Velodrome is the quarterfinals of the women's Kirin. And we've got three races here. This is the start list for the first quarterfinal in the women's Kirin. Katie Marchant, Olympic bronze in the sprint in 2016. Emma Hines, EYG from Hong Kong, former world champion. Lauren van Riesen, fourth in the World Championships in 2018. Darius Shmleva, bronze at the World Championships in 2019. And Olena Starikova.
Eddie Marchant from Great Britain. So the idea is to be in the top four so they can proceed to the semi-finals. If you finish fifth or sixth in this particular race, it is game over here at the Olympics in Tokyo. So a very, very important race to stay in the competition and move into the semi-final. Starikova, a lot of experience in the Ukraine rider.
Lauren van Riesen.
Famous for her bike handling skills. So much concentration.
Labor of bronze at the World Championships 2 years ago. In London, Lee. The gun and the start of the first quarter final in the women's Kirin. The Durney's on the track.
The Durney will do three laps and then swing off, and then at the final three laps we'll see the riders contest for their positions. At the moment they must stay in formation behind the Durney. Katie Marchant, we saw her in earlier heats riding right from the back. That's where she feels comfortable. It's worked for her in the previous heats, but this could actually be a final with a lineup so strong. It's not going to be easy for any of these riders. Two of them will miss out, four of them will go through to the semi-final.
The Durney increases in speed with every lap.
Yeah, the Durney will go out at 25 kilometers per hour, lifting it to 45 kilometers per hour in three laps. So when he swings off with three laps to go, they'll be riding at 45k an hour, and they'll sprint at between 60 and 70 kilometers per hour. So you can just see some action going on at the back now. It's Hines trying to make it hard for Katie Marchant. But if you worry too much about the rider behind you, the thing's up front. So here goes Hines from Germany now, just trying to box in one of the riders.
Starikova on the front. Hines now on the outside for Lauren van Riesen alongside her. Marchant in the middle there, just bumping and boring with the whoop. Vijay Weep. Now they come to the bell. Starikova, big crash. Katie Marchant, Lauren van Riesen go down.
Two of the big favourites have just come down heavy. Hines will go through. I think it was van Riesen that clipped the back of her wheel. So they're your four riders that will go through to the semi-final. Very unfortunate for van Riesen and Katie Marchant, two of the big favourites for the gold medal.
Well, great drama and disappointment. Disappointment for Marchant van Riesen, who had a big scare in Rio 5 years ago. Meanwhile, it's EYG from Hong Kong who wins. Starikova in second, Labor in third, and Hines in fourth place. The first four go to the semi-final, so all four are through.
Well, it's one of the big risks you take when you decide to ride from the back, that it can all get clustered up. You can see Van Riesen just overlapped Heinz's wheel there and took out Katie Marchant with her. And it's a big reason for the Kieran. She tried to come out of that box that she was in, but she was overlapped. Two riders come down, so we see the replay now as Van Riesen just clips the wheel of Heinz and takes Katie Marchant down with her.
A concern from the Dutch team there. And Katie Marchant will roll in. Thankfully, no serious injury to her. There's treatment still for Lauren van Riesen trackside, but it is a very dangerous discipline, is the Kieran.
Yeah, the riders were trying to get out of what we call the box when you get boxed in by another rider. And unfortunately for Van Riesen, she didn't have enough room to get out of that box and just misjudged the wheel in front of her. This is Katie Marchant. She will not be happy with this result.
So the Dixon medical team on hand here, seeing to Lauren van Riesen.
They take as much precaution as they can. If you have an accident and feel some pain anywhere, they'll ask you to stay still until they've done the medical overview.
Meanwhile, Hong Kong's Li Weiji straight onto the bike, because the racing will continue. Second place, Starikova from the Ukraine. And Daria Shmleva took third, and Emma Heinz was the fourth rider across the line of the four. Eventually finished.
So repairs being done to the track. Every time there's a crash, they must assess the track and make sure that there are no pieces of wood sticking up. And there's the results from the quarterfinals, heat one.
Iwaji from Hong Kong, Elena Tarikova from Ukraine, Shmleva from the Russian Olympic Committee, and Germany's Emma Heinz through to the semifinals. Lauren van Riesen and Katie Marchant had a coming together on the track and didn't finish the race, leaving those four to go through. Heat two in the women's Kieran, and this is the start list. Lauriane Genest from Canada, Mathilde Gross, Leah Sophie Friedrich, already a gold medalist here in the sprint. Danielle Gaishola, Shan Respanix, and Elise Andrews from New Zealand.
A slightly easier heat looking on paper, but we're going to see some close racing here as the coaches try to fire up the legs of their riders.
Friedrich trying to join Emma Heinz, her teammate, in the semi-finals. This is Elise Andrews, the 21-year-old New Zealander. Daniela Gaishola from Mexico. This is the World Championships 6 years ago. and the best result.
Mathilde Grosse from France. She's been to the Japanese Kirins. She'll have a lot of experience as the last rider comes up onto the track.
That's Ras Penix from the Netherlands, former world championship silver medalist. Friedrich, this is Genest, the 2019 Pan American Championship. Mathilde Grosse, the 22-year-old Frenchwoman. Janae Ras Penix, silver medalist in 2015 at the World Championships. And the New Zealander, Les Andrews, fifth at the World Championships last year. Gagiola is at the bottom of the track. You can see the Durney coming around the bend now.
Well, the aim for these riders is to finish in the top four to move into the semi-finals. And for the two riders that are in fifth and sixth position, they will not go through to the semi-finals. So the Durney will do three laps, and then the riders will do three laps without the Durney. The Durney starts at 25 kilometres per hour, builds up to 45 kilometres per hour.
Sophie Friedrich right at the back here. This was Emma Heinz at the in the previous quarterfinal. Ashola, the Mexican, as we've seen her in previous rounds, also right behind the Durney. And it's Andrews, Brespenix, Ross, Genes, and Friedrich.
Well, Friedrich riding at the back. You'd have to be a bit concerned after seeing that last heat. It's very difficult and dangerous being at the back in a Kirin race. Riders in the front can take a little bit more control if they've got the strength and power.
And this is laying off the wheel a little bit here. Okay, in second place.
Good tactic by the New Zealander just to leave a little bit of the gap to the Mexican rider. She wants to back off the rider from Netherlands.
Friedrich starting to make a move. Ross as well. The Durney's gone. The racing's on. Mathilde Grosse has made a move, but Andrew's on the front. She likes to be on the front at this stage, but he's coming under pressure from Grosse.
Well, Andrews was in that prime position behind the Durney. She has to back herself to be strong enough and take control of this race, and it's looking good so far. One lap to go. Here comes the Canadian now.
Friedrich and Brespanics are a little bit in trouble here. Certainly Friedrich, as Andrews is looking to lose pace. On the outside is Canadian Genest. Gashola is there as well, but Andrews is holding on. She's got great strength. Here comes Brespanics, and she will win it. What a ride.
What an amazing ride from Brespanics. That was super, super power. Wow, haven't the Dutch really got on form with their sprinting legs here? They are absolutely flying.
Well, she looked for all money buried around the back, but she came through so strong.
Well, great ride from the New Zealander, Elise Andrews. She will go through to the semi-final.
You heard Gashola, Genest, and Brespanics. The top four going through, going out to Mathilde Grosse and the German Lea Sophie Friedrich. The winner of Heat 2 in the women's Kirin quarterfinals, Janae Brespanics. Powerful last kick over the last 100 metres or so.
Well, she's shown her cards now, the rider from Netherlands, Brespanics. She had a perfect ride. See a bit of elbow bumping there. That's what Kirin racing is about. And look at Brespanics come now from the Netherlands around the outside. It's not easy to come three or four wide, but she does it with so much strength.
Impressive sprinting. The Dutch really is, Michelle said, have really got their sprinting act together here for sure. Both the men and the women. And Andrews just taking second. Confirming Shanae Brespanics' impressive win in Heat 2 of the women's Kirin quarterfinals ahead of Elise Andrews, as well as Gashola and Genes will go through to the semi-finals. A final quarterfinal in the women's Kirin. And a six-rider strong, very strong. Carly McCullough, Kelsey Mitchell, Chan Chizong, and it's Kobayashi, Livia Vasova, and Madeline Godby from the United States. Meridia gold medalist. Here is Carly McCullough.
Some serious concentration. These riders have to finish in the top four to go through to the semi-final. And the Australian Carly McCullough, she has had a really hard fight to get selection for the Olympics here in Tokyo. But she's here now, and all these riders will have their stories of how difficult it has been and the challenges they've had to overcome to actually get on the start line for Tokyo Olympics.
Song Jianqi on the front, former sprint champion, and McCullough. And it's Vasova in the blue of the Ukraine. And it's the hopes of Japan on Kobayashi Yuka. And the Canadian Mitchell and Madeline Godby. It's the first American to be invited to, American woman to be invited to race the Japan Kirin circuit. So she's got that experience with her.
Kirin racing has slightly changed at UCI level. It's a longer sprint for the riders once the journey comes off. Instead of 2.5 laps, it's 3 laps, but it makes a really big difference to train your sprint to be that much longer. Carly McCullough from Australia looking in a good position here in second place. She just needs to be careful not to be jumped, and that's why she's going to keep an eye over her shoulder, leave some distance.
Journey's off. Vasova in the blue is making a move. Zhong Jianqi is leading at the moment. Here goes Vasova. Kobayashi is just on her wheel.
Good move from the Japanese rider, Yobashashi, and she's got Carly McCullough boxed in, as does Canada. Big move there.
So Mitchell is coming around for Canada, takes the bell in the lead. Zhong Jianqi in second, Carly McCullough. Vasova is a little off the wheel there. Mitchell's holding strong here. She's looking very impressive from the Canadian. Remember, top four go through. And it'll be Canada, Australia, China, and the Ukraine. Out go the United States and Japan.
Oh, Kelsey Mitchell, she's fast, she's strong from Canada. And she had the confidence to come around the riders. She's got a long enough sprint. That was another impressive ride from the Canadian.
Oh, very impressive from Kelsey Mitchell, 27-year-old. Bronze at the Pan American Champs a couple of years ago, 2019. Only got into this track racing in 2017. Zhong Jianqi in third place behind Carly McCullough. And she'll be joined with Livia Vasova there in the blue from Ukraine in the semi-finals of the women's Kirin.
Some exciting racing to come from the women's Kirin. It's actually described as a contact sport in Japan, in the Japanese Kirins. And you see the strength there of Kelsey Mitchell, the Canadian. One of the fastest women on a bike, I must say. And she demonstrated it right there. Happy coach, happy rider. Through to the semi-finals.
Yeah, looking very, very impressive. So, three Mitchell, McCullough, Zhong Jianqi, and Vasova. No luck for Madeline Godby and Kobayashi Yuta. Through to the semi-finals, Carly McCullough, Marianne Jeanette, Kelsey Mitchell, Jianqi Zhong, Emma Heinz, Li Weiji, as well as Nanshola, Braspanex, Andrews, Shmleva, Vasova, and Starikova. Two from the Ukraine.
An exciting race coming up in the men's sprint. It's not often you'd see Jason Kenny back in a repechage. Three riders on the track, one rider goes through to the quarterfinals, and no repechages for the other riders. So the first heat on the line.
Away goes the first repechage in the last eight of the men's sprint. Three riders up here. Mohamed Awang, Yuta Wakimoto, and Jason Kenny. On the front, the defending champion, Jason Kenny. The winner of each heat qualifies for the quarterfinals. So this is a do-or-die race for the defending champion from Great Britain.
Yeah, and he's been called up because there's a jump come from the Japanese rider, Okimoto. But Kenny wants to play this safe. No tactics involved. He wants to use just strength and power and speed as Owen gets on the wheel. He's going to have trouble coming off, but it is possible. Let's see what Jason Kenny's got.
Has Owen got the power to get past the defending champion here? Kenny has the lead on the bed, the final bend. Owen's digging deep, but is he going to get through? No, Jason Kenny holds on and is through to the quarterfinals. He's a champion. He races. He knows what to do, but he's having to work hard.
Well, his experience is certainly coming into play. He knew he had to ride from the front. He is really, really happy about moving on to the quarterfinals. A moment on the start line. The amount of emotions going through the minds of these riders. And Jason Kenny, he took it out from the front just to be safe. He got pushed from Owang, but he was strong enough. He was fast enough. Jason Kenny goes into the quarterfinals of the men's sprint. That was heat one. One more heat to go, but he's happy to be through to the quarterfinals. It wasn't easy, but he used his experience and tactics.
Well, he's a true champion, is Jason Kenny. And they work incredibly hard as Kenny takes his place into the quarterfinals. And it doesn't come easy. They may make it look easy, these superstars, but they put in the hard yards year in and year out, month in, month out. Although Kenny took a year off, and perhaps that was a good thing, bearing in mind the Olympics were delayed by a year.
Yeah, in that case, I think he made the right decision as the riders from the second heat are now being rolled out onto the track.
Heat two in the repechage, last eight round the men's sprint, features Frenchman Sébastien Vigier, Mohamed Shafidas Sharom from Malaysia. John Beasley holding him up there. He's got a busy time with two riders in the sprint. And Sam Webster from New Zealand. Rene Wolf, the former World and Olympic champion, his coach. Heat two in the last eight finals. A repechage. The men's sprint is underway. Three riders, Sharom, Vigier and Webster. Malaysia, France and New Zealand. Webster on the front.
Yeah, the New Zealander wants to take it from the front, see if he can use his power. He's got to be careful with Sharom coming off the wheel because the Malaysians are fast coming off the wheel. But it's a big jump and a big attack now from the Frenchman.
Vigier now in second place. Not the ideal spot, but he's showing his intentions here. Webster. Now here comes Sharom. Vigier.
Vigier has to deal with two riders here. He's got to try and keep Sharom behind him and also stay in the slipstream of Sam Webster.
He's gone long now. Vigier, there's a bit too much ground to make up perhaps, but he's going to take the wheel. Sharom is having to work hard. Webster's holding the line. Now comes Vigier. He will take the win. Well done, Sébastien Vigier. Good ride.
Yeah, very deserving win for Vigier, the Frenchman, to go through. He goes through to the quarterfinals. Unfortunately, it's the end of competition for the other two riders. This was one of the repercharges. So we now have the slow-mo, the power used by Vigier here to pass Sharom. And he gets onto the wheel of Sam Webster and he comes off it like dynamite. Very, very well-deserved win there by Vigier of France. He'll go through to the quarterfinals.
France have a history of producing great sprinters over the years and a new generation. And they've got a very handy looking young women's team pursuit squad and a men's squad, so they are building nicely for Paris. Through to the quarterfinals, Jason Kenny and Sébastien Vigier in the men's sprint. Last eight repechage round. Long time since Jason Kenny had to go that way round to get into the quarterfinals.
Well, it's the first time we've seen so much emotion from Jason Kenny as well. He was certainly very, very happy to have won that repechage and be back in competition. And even though he may be lacking a little bit of speed, he's still a very good gold medal chance for this year's Olympics.
Well, he's got such experience. Our second event in the four event men's Omnium, and this is the standings after the scratch race. Matthew Walls took the maximum 40 points. Benjamin Thomas, the world champion, from 38. Jan Willem from Skip in third place. So all the way down it goes as the 20 riders take to the track for the second event, which is the tempo race, which has been introduced since the last Olympic cycle as a new event here. 10 kilometers, 40 laps, and points on offer.
The riders will get one lap for a win across the line every lap. They'll
one point, that is, for every lap they go after the first five.
First four or five?
Yeah.
Laps are just a neutral, settling in, getting positions, and then they'll get a whistle that the next lap will be a sprint lap. And every lap for this 40 laps will be a sprint lap, but only the rider who wins will take one point. So this is the second event of the men's Omnium. We've had our first event, the scratch race. Great Britain, the leader, and that's why he gets position one on the fence.
So, 10 kilometres, 40 laps. There is Benjamin Thomas. He goes to the bottom because he's in second place. And then it's Jan Willems and Skip who goes to the top. And France enjoying prominence here on day four at the Tokyo 2020 Games.
So the tempo race, 40 laps, and as we say, you gain one point for crossing the line first for each lap after the neutralized laps. And we won't actually see sprinting for the line. What we're going to see is riders trying to constantly get to the front, so a super, super fast movement. Every lap you want to be positioned near the front and cross that line first. As we go through the riders on the fence, a thumbs up from the Austrian.
Yeah, 41-year-old is Thomas Müller.
We saw the face of Elia Viviani, and he's not looking confident after finishing 13th in the scratch race. But he is the reigning Olympic champion.
The whistle for the second event in the men's Omnium. 20 riders on the track as they take to the track for the tempo race. And they will have five warm-up laps, and then it'll be a point for every lap. And the accumulated the highest number of points at the end will win and pick up the 40 points. Those points that they win on the race will not count to their overall standings.
So we see the Australian now. The race has actually started, so there'll be points awarded for the next time over the line.
Matthew Walls is the overall leader so far on the Omnium after the first event. That's him on the front, Benjamin Thomas behind him.
Well, we heard the gun go. They've got 39 laps to go now. Viviani will take the first points, and he knows that he needs to stay near the front continually throughout this race.
Viviani's got ground to make up, the defending champion. Busy program on the road, Elia Viviani. Roll through again. I think that they've had a warm up. Here we go.
The front of the race. They've got 37 laps to go. There's Matthew Wells. Takes to the front, riding high on the track. Bell lap. This will actually be the first lap that the riders take points. So that was their neutral laps were included in the first 40 laps, and now the race is on. So very fast start from the New Zealander. It is Campbell Stewart taking the first points.
Campbell Stewart to go through the world champion from 2019.
He's going to continue on and see if he can take points again.
He's got Yoheni Karoliak, the scratch race world champion, on his wheel here. Oh, that is so close. I can't call that. Very, very close. They're going to have a look at that. The referee's commissaires as Walls goes to the front now to see if he can pick up a point for Great Britain.
And he will. Now he'll swing off. Japanese rider as well swings off and slips back into about fifth position.
So much tactics and awareness needed here by the riders as to who's where and what as the man from Kazakhstan goes through, Artem Zakharov, the Asian Omnium champion of a few years ago.
Yeah, so we've had Campbell Stewart, then the rider from Belarus take the points, and then Matthew Wells from Great Britain, and then Kazakhstan, and this time it was Sam Welsford from Australia taking the points.
Benjamin Thomas is trying to get in position to try and get on the points as well. The world champion Welsford and Thomas. Thomas will take it.
So we've got six riders on 1 point at this moment, but it's the world champion really applying the pressure now, and what a move from Benjamin Thomas.
Hashimoto Iya from Japan is there, but Thomas picks up a second point there, so he goes to the virtual lead at the moment. Three riders just a little clear of the group now.
Yeah, a really good move from the strong rider Benjamin Thomas as the Japanese rider takes a point as well.
And Matthew Walls is starting to try and close the gap there. The Great Britain rider closing in on the back of that lead trio as Thomas will take another point.
Well, Thomas has 3 points now, so he's the leader. The only other riders have 1 point. And here comes Wells.
Yeah, he's seen Thomas hoovering up the 3 points there. He thinks, well, I've got to get some points here if I need to win this, as he takes this one quite comfortably. A point a lap it is. No one else gets points.
Matthew Wells, he has 2 points now. And if he can win this sprint, he'll be on equal points with Benjamin Thomas. And he does.
Comfortably so, with Gavin Hoover of the United States now giving chase. Seventh at the World Championships last year. Hoover from New York, the 24-year-old.
Well, the New Zealander Campbell Stewart coming onto the wheel there, but it will be USA.
No one looking at the moment as if they're going to lap the field, although Austria and Ireland, Miller and Downey quite far down, as Roger Kluger, the big man from Germany, goes through to take a point.
Kluger takes his points as the rider from Netherlands comes through. Van Schip, will he be able to? Yes, it looks like he's going to be able to take these points.
He's been out of the points thus far. He was third overall, but no, it's going to be Larsen who takes the point. I fancy there for Denmark.
Well, this is a good move from the Frenchman making it into that little gap. If he can get another point, he'll be the leader at the moment. He's on equal. No, he's actually leading. He's got 3 points.
Thierry Skier from Switzerland picked up the point on that lap. His first.
So Benjamin Thomas from France is holding the lead at the moment with Matthew Wells in second place. And now, ooh, a little bit of indecision from those riders out in front.
Downey, the Irishman, is being lapped as here comes Larsen. But Skier is going to take it for Switzerland again. And he moves into third. So just Thomas and Wells, Walls with 3 points apiece.
And another point for Van Schip.
He now joins Skier on 2 points. So Larsen, Elle Viviani, and Skip, Thomas, and Skier in the lead group of five.
Larsen takes another point. He's now on 2 points.
Viviani, well, hasn't yet shown his form, but he's in this lead group, which is important.
Yeah, 17 laps, 16 laps now to go for the leaders. As Van Schip takes the points again, Larsen comes through. Viviani on the wheel. We'll have to see something special from Viviani if he wants to get a good position in this tempo race, the second race of the men's Omnium. And he does take the points this time. Viviani puts himself in sixth position.
Defending champion finally on the board here. And this could be the catch as well.
Terry Shear took the points from Switzerland. That lap puts him into fourth position. Equal first, actually, with 3 points. We've now got four riders on 3 points.
Thomas Walls and Skuer from Switzerland.
Okay, the front of the race is Van Schip.
He picks up another point to go to the top of the table on four.
Well, he's now leading the race. The rider from Netherlands. And he's... Well, the Belgian rider takes that point.
And four riders have gained 20 points thanks to gaining a lap there. So Thomas Skuer, Larsen and Viviani benefited. Miller and Dani have lost points. They've been lapped.
Well, the Polish rider that time takes the points. It's very, very hard to identify the front of the race. But overall, we have Benjamin Thomas, 23 points. For taking a lap, they got 20 points.
All right, indication is that Van Schip is still the lead rider here.
So for taking a lap, the rider's got 20 points.
And they are accumulating more and more riders taking the lap here as
Benjamin Thomas still at the top of the leaders board, but he is equal position with two other riders, Matthew Walls and Terry Shear. So they're all on 23 points, largely to that lap that was taken.
Well, I can tell you what, things are going on down trackside. But the commissaires, the Dane, Niklas Larsen, the Danish team believe Niklas Larsen might be in the lead here. But nevertheless, they race on, and another point goes the way of the Spaniard now. First point for Alberto Torres. The indication is that Van Schip is still the lead rider.
Yeah, and he's tactically hanging off the back there to take more points for each lap before he makes contact. And we'll see when he comes around this time. He is still the leader of the race. So that was well done by Van Schip. He wants to hang off the back of that. He doesn't want to take the 20 points just yet. He wants to take a few more one-pointers before he makes contact and calls it 20 points.
And he can get out of reach with four laps to go.
Takes the points again, 1 point. At some point he's going to have to close that gap and take his 20 points because there's only four laps to go and the peloton will start to really wind it up.
Jan Willem van Schip was the winner of this particular discipline at the World Championships in Berlin last year. And he ended up finishing second in the silver medal position. Now he's starting to make a move. And will make the catch.
So 20 points now to Van Schip, and the lead of the race goes back to the front with Kluger on the front. Benjamin Thomas in second position. The leader of the race is Van Schip because of his tactics. But for this point, Roger Kluger takes that point. And no doubt it'll be the Frenchman of Benjamin Thomas who takes the next point. The leader of the race on 30 points is Van Schip. Here comes the Frenchman.
Benjamin Thomas and Campbell-Stewart.
Campbell-Stewart takes those points.
Very tight in the sprint.
Yeah. So for the tempo race, which was the second race of the men's Omnium, the winner of the tempo race is this man, the Dutchman, Van Schip. He rode so solidly to take those one-pointers, which actually really counted because when he took that one lap and had the 20 points, he jumped into the lead with 30 points. So first place for Van Schip. Second for Benjamin Thomas, and third to Great Britain, Matthew Walls.
Well, Walls has done well there, having won the scratch race, but Van Schip and Thomas, the medalists from the World Championships, the four men are very much in form here in Tokyo. Well, there was, whilst the race was going on, the Danes were protesting vociferously with the commissaires about something. Van Schipsel smiles. Very tactically astute riding from him.
So even though Van Schip got 30 points in that race, he takes the 40 points for winning the tempo race. And now we can see the current standings. After two races, Van Schip leads the Omnium.
Yeah, it's Van Schip just looking over, making sure his tactics are in place. And there he goes, just making that catch to ensure he picked up the lap when it mattered towards the end of the race. There's Matthew Walls. A good job done by the Dutchman. And a bat on the back for Walls. Two done in the Omnium of four on the day. The medalists, the gold medalists, will be crowned today, unlike previous games. So confirming the results of the men's Omnium, Jan Willem van Schip from the Netherlands winning that. Benjamin Thomas, the tempo race, beg your pardon, in second place. And Matthew Walls in third, Skier in fourth. All the way down the list, a couple of riders losing points as well. Finishing down the order, Downey, Müller and Maria. There's Benjamin Thomas.
He's got the ice vest on already. It's so important. They only have 20 to 40 minutes between each race, so it's all about the recovery. They've had two races of four. We'll see another two very exciting races.
After two events in the men's Omnium, it's so tight, all square. Jan Willem van Schip, Matthew Walls and Benjamin Thomas all on 76 points. Larsen, Skier, Hoover, De Kettler and Zakharov. Ele Viviani, the defending champion, down in 11th place on 42 points. Well, he really has to produce the goods in the remaining two events, the elimination and the points race. Move back to the sprints, and it's time for the quarterfinals of the men's sprint. It's getting down to the business end here. And the winner of these qualifies for the semi-finals. Geoffrey Hugeland against Sebastian Viver of France in our first quarterfinal in the men's sprint. Hugeland has looked imperious, so comfortable in all his races thus far. Vigier has had to go somewhat circuitous route through the repechage rounds. Away they go in our first heat in the quarterfinals of the men's sprint. Sebastian Vigier on the front for France and the silver medalist for the World Championships, Geoffrey Hugeland from the Netherlands.
Well, the winner of these heats go to the semi-finals. And the losers will race for 5th to 8th place at this Tokyo Olympics. Vigier just keeping a close eye on Hugeland. It's a mental game. Hugeland has looked so composed all the way through this competition. And Vigier wants Hugeland to go to the front, but it's not going to happen. Hugeland just a little bit too experienced. Vigier picks up the speed now. So much confidence from Hugeland.
How do you beat this Dutchman? He's looked almost untouchable in his races thus far. So confident.
He's doing exactly what he wants to do here. Putting Vigier under pressure. Making him go long straight round with ease. Unbelievable form. He can switch it off. He'll get the word from the coaches just to take the pressure off the legs. And he sits up in the straight and just cruises in. Incredible power from Geoffrey Hugeland.
Well, he's looking in such good form with Geoffrey Hugeland. Sebastian Villa knew that the game was up fairly early on there. And Hugeland could tap it off going into the bend. And a comfortable win. He's through to the semi-finals.
Well, we see him on the start line so focused. and the move that he made when he came around. It was so fast that Vigier knew there was nothing he could do. He couldn't even fight to get on the wheel. So good tactics from Hoogland to do the move early and the power early and be able to just switch the legs off and roll into the finish. He looks incredibly hard to beat.
Well, it's building up to a really intense battle for the medals, but that's later on, because we've still got a quarterfinal on our hands here, and this is one to savor.
This is going to be an unbelievable race. Jason Kenny up against the in-form Leveresen from the Netherlands. And Jason Kenny will have to win this race if he wants to try and defend his title in the men's sprint. And I'm sure he'd be very, very nervous coming up against the form that the Dutchmen are in. And Leveresen, he has also looked untouchable until this point.
Jason Kenny, the defending champion in the men's sprint, up against the world champion, Harry Leveresen. Leveresen's won the world title in the last 2 years. Second quarterfinal underway in the men's sprint. Jason Kenny, the defending champion from Great Britain, up against the world champion, Harry Leveresen, behind him. And well, this is a race of truth for Kenny. He loses this, he cannot defend his gold medal won in Rio.
No, if he loses this race, he'll be racing for 5th to 6th place. Leveresen goes through, it could be that we end up seeing an all-Dutch final for the gold medal, which will be very exciting. But let's see what can Jason Kenny do here with all the years of experience.
He's going to have to dig deep into that bag of experience today against a man who has looked so, so good. He looks over his shoulder now, and Kenny will be second man now, and Leveresen with such power all the way through his rounds.
Good move by Leveresen. I'm not sure Kenny can do it from this position. With one lap to go, Leveresen hasn't hit full straps yet. Down the back straight, he starts to wind it up. And now he'll just ride his fastest lap he possibly can. Jason Kenny trying to come off the wheel around the big Dutchman. Can he do it? No, he can't. Leveresen goes through, and the dream of another gold medal for Jason Kenny is finished in the men's sprint here.
So the defending champion goes out in the quarterfinals of the men's sprint, and the Dutch march on, two riders through. Well, this Dutchman is in such form, and Kenny, well, he's perhaps having to dig deeper than ever before.
Yeah, not the usual face of Kenny we see on the start line. Not so much confidence. I think he knew it's going to be very difficult to beat the Dutchman Leveresen in such fine form. Both the Dutchmen look so strong, Leveresen and Hoogland, as we see Leveresen comfortably taking the win there from Jason Kenny. Nothing he could do, Kenny. It's going to be difficult now for him to gather his thoughts and race for the 5th to 8th place.
Our third race in the quarterfinals. And an opportunity for Great Britain's Jack Carlin. So Jack Carlin, Great Britain, up against Max Levy. So first race in this quarterfinal. Max Levy and Jack Carlin, Germany against Great Britain, in the quarterfinals of the men's sprint, race one.
And Levy takes it from the front, Carlin from the back. Carlin making it clear now that he wants to race this one from the back.
just informed you, it's a best of three series, these quarterfinals. So both Vigier and Kennedy have a chance to pull one back over the Dutch riders. But this is Great Britain against Germany, Max Levy and Jack Collin.
Well, Collin just forcing the pace of Levy, trying to get him to wind it up early. He's looking, Collin, to come off the wheel, which is going to be very hard with Levy, but he's backing his form and his speed. Collin getting some speed off the banking. He comes underneath. He gets the sprinter's lane. That was a superb move. And it's over for Levy.
Well, Great Britain pulling one out here through Jack Collin. Great riding. Bold move, diving down and taking the sprinter's line. And Max Levy was well beaten then.
It's just the reactions that these riders have to have. Collin took advantage of the sprint lane being open and he got into it so quickly that there was nothing Levy could do. And he'll count that, Levy, as a big, big mistake, leaving that door open. I'm going to see the slow-mo here now. The grip, the white knuckles. Here's the move. So fast into the sprinter's lane. Nothing Levy could do. He couldn't get down there and close the door quick enough. And Collin pushes on as he realises now that Levy has given up the race. He switches it off.
Even had a moment to look down, look back, and just to make sure that his move had worked. So Collin goes through into the second race with an advantage over Levy. And the last of the quarterfinals involves Nicholas Paul and Denis Dmitriev. The fastest man over the sprint, Nicholas Paul. 9.100, his time recorded at in Bolivia at the Pan American Championships in 2019. But that counts for little here. It's all about winning these races, not about time. Denis Dmitriev, totally focused, man from the Russian Olympic Committee. Trinidad and Tobago.
So off the line, Dmitriev. What can he do against the fastest man in the world from Trinidad and Tobago? Nicholas Paul, we see from the on-bike camera, so focused. As we saw in that last heat, you have to be responsive, you have to be fast. Denis Dmitriev, the onboard camera, just looking back at Nicholas Paul as Paul takes the bike all the way up to the top of the track. He now closes in the gap.
Well, so much experience in Dmitriev's legs.
Well, I think the experience is in Dmitriev's legs, but is he strong enough to hold off this man, Nicholas Paul, who's trying to force him to wind up early? As he pushes the pace high at the track, he wants to stay high to get that run off the banking. And forces him. Oh, he's done the same move underneath, and he's done it successfully.
Nicholas Paul now holds sway as he drives off the front. And Dmitriev has so much work to do. Nicholas Paul of Trinidad and Tobago is going to bring this home. Dmitriev is finishing strongly, but Paul's going to take the win over the 2017 world champion.
Well, a few mistakes being made. You have to be fully attentive at all times. And the reactions of these sprinters are so quick. Taking in the deep breaths on the start line, psyching themselves up. And Nicholas Paul dives underneath Dmitriev, takes him high on the track again. And then he comes down into the sprinter's lane and puts everything into it. And there was no answers to that kind of strength and speed. Nicholas Paul eases his way through.
Confirming Nicholas Paul's win over Denis Dmitriev in the quarterfinals. I'll come back for another round in a short while. best of three, these quarterfinals. So we move on in today's program. We get closer and closer to the medals in the women's Kirin. And it is now getting down to the business end of this competition. The women's Kirin semi-finals, two races, and the first three riders in each heat qualify for the final. The others advance to the B final, 7 to 12. There's the start list here. Zhong Chanxi, Iwaji, Skajola, Andrews, Basova, and Sarikova. Two Ukrainians in the same race here. Iwaji.
Well, Basova and Starikova from Ukraine. They have the chance to work together, help each other out a little bit. That will be the coach's decision if that is to happen. They may have been told race independently.
And Junji, the sprint world champion from almost 8 years ago. Iwashi, the world champion from 2019, fourth in 2020. Daniela Gajola. Basova, fifth in Rio 5 years ago. And the European champion from last year, Zarikova. Plenty of quality packed into this race. The far side of the track, the Derny starts its journey around the bend, building up to a pace to get to the riders. The gun will go and the riders will fall in behind the Derny.
The Derny will pass now at 25 kilometers per hour, and off they go, fighting for positions behind the Derny.
This is the first semi-final in the women's Kirin. Ukraine have two riders in here then. Zhong Chanxi, BYG, Daniela Gajola, Elise Andrews, and Lyubia Basova and Olena Starikova.
Well, a good move from the Ukrainian riders to take position one and two behind the Derny, and that does indicate that they are indirectly assisting each other.
Well, Olena Starikova is the one in the black helmet in front of her teammate Basova. Remember, first three in the race will go through to contest the medal event. The other three will go to the B final. No moves yet from the back of the field. Andrews has been very impressive for New Zealand. She's sitting in sixth place at the moment.
Yeah, we can expect a jump from Andrews.
The Derny will leave the track now. It's racing on.
Well, this is the problem, riding from the back. A long way for Andrews to come now. But it's the Mexican just takes to the lead. A bit of touch of wheels there. Here comes Andrews. So strong around the outside and into the front position. Still two laps to go, three laps to go.
She enjoys the long sprint, Andrews. We saw in the quarterfinals do the same thing. She's going hard. Yong Chanxi and Li Weiji as well from Hong Kong. Here comes China's Yong Chanxi.
Zhong Chanxi's doing it the long way around. A big fight from the New Zealand rider. One lap to go. Such a big fight. She's gone so early. The legs are tiring. The riders are bumping. It's close racing. It's the first three that'll go through. Here comes Ukraine around the outside. Can the New Zealander hold on? Everyone's so tired.
First three are through. And it looks like Ukraine certainly got one. Down goes rider just after the finish. But Ukraine at least had one there. Andrews went through as well. And it looks like Lyubia Basova, Denise Andrews and Olena Starikova have gone through.
Yeah, the two Ukrainian riders and the New Zealander, Elise Andrews, goes through. It was the Mexican Gajola that we saw come down after the finish. Also extremely disappointed that she misses out on going through to the semi-final. The 1-6 final, should I say. She'll now be racing for 7th to 12th.
Well, there is Olena Starikova, the European champion. And they're having a fantastic Kieran series here. This is a look at that very, very tight sprint.
Yeah, really, really impressive riding by the New Zealander. She went with three laps to go on the front, which is not easy to do. And you could see how much fatigue were in the legs of all the riders having to sprint so long. And we see the two Ukrainians and the New Zealand rider go through to the very highly anticipated final of the Kieran.
Yeah, Shola was in fourth only just. She went down after the finish. Thankfully, she's up and walking in unassisted, which is a good sign.
Yeah, she gets a cheer from the crowd, as do the Ukrainian riders. And the Mexican will have one more ride tonight to race for the 7th to 12th places.
Confirming the result of the first semi-final in the women's Kieran, a 1-2 for Ukraine in terms of going through, but Elise Andrews splitting the pair. But those three will go through to the final. Yashola Liwaji and Zhang Qizhong will contest the B final. The second semi-final in the women's Kieran, Carly McCullough from Australia, two Canadians, Lauriane Genet and Kelsey Mitchell. Germany's Emma Heinz, Shan Brospanix from the Netherlands, and Dara Shmleva from the Russian Olympic Committee.
Well, this certainly is a packed heat. All the top names here. Kieran Racing, it's so close. You have to be really, really switched on for this race in positioning. Positioning is everything. Some of the stronger riders, we saw the Canadian Kelsey Mitchell just take it from the back and come around at the last minute. You have to have so much confidence to do that. And then other riders that take it on from the front, they can end up making their way through to the finals just because they've stayed out of trouble and not had to go wide.
Well, Canada have two cards to play here. Lauriane Genet, Pan American champion from 2019. This is Emma Heinz, world champion, of course, she is. Kelsey Mitchell, been very, very impressive, the bronze medal of the Pan American Championships. Lauriane Genet, Shan Brospanix. All focus. What a race here for Carly McCullough, having worked so hard to get to the games. Bronze medalist of the World Championships 2 years ago. This is the second semi-final in the women's Kieran of Tokyo 2020. Six riders, first three go through to the final.
So the Derny comes along as they come off the line and fight for their positions on the Derny. The Derny goes at 25 kilometres per hour and builds up to 45 kilometres per hour within three laps and then pulls off. And the race riders will increase their speed up to 60 kilometres per hour. And it's the Canadian who takes the Derny, the front position, staying out of trouble. They've got two riders, two possibilities here.
Yeah, it looks like Genet has taken the first wheel and then it's Mleva. Carly McCullough is in there as well. Then it's Brospanix. Second of the Canadians, Kelsey Mitchell, and then at the back of the field, Emma Heinz.
Yeah, well, Heinz will be predicting that Mitchell is going to go long and early around to the front with a lot of power.
She has won from that position earlier in the rounds, and she is the world champion.
And she's being jumped right now by the German rider, so we get some action from the peloton. Heinz is taken to the lead. Respanik's on a wheel, and Heinz takes the lead early on. Stays out of trouble. Carly McCulloch on third. And here comes the Canadian. She's very, very fast. Kelsey Mitchell straight to the front. I don't think her pure speed can be matched.
Two laps to go. Kelsey Mitchell goes early and has opened up a bit of a gap. Emma Heinz is closing it down. Joan Braspanek's with her. Lauriane Genest is there as well. It's a very tightly bunched race, this, as Mitchell holds the lead. But Braspanek's will take the bell in the lead.
Carly McCulloch high on the banking. She's trying to get around the Canadians and on the wheel of Braspanek's. Can she do it? Can she make it through to the final? It's going to be a hard ask.
Only three through. Braspanek's does it, and the Canada might have two riders through there. It was very close with Shimlava on the inside. We may have to wait for that result, but no question about Sinead Braspanek's. Kelsey Mitchell is through. We'll wait and see, and it is. Lauriane Genest has got through. The results are showing up in the stadium, but there is your race winner, Sinead Braspanek's.
Well, how much it changed in the last 30 metres. That's the length and the speed of this Kieran. They can really die in the finish, but Braspanek's a very good ride. Kelsey Mitchell takes second, and her teammate Lauriane Genest goes through as well. They are extremely happy to have two in the final.
And so they should be. What a performance. So third place to Lauriane Genest. And that means that Canada and Ukraine each have two riders in the final.
Well, we see the slow-mo once the journey comes off and the racing starts. There was a big move from Heinz early, which cost her. And this is the final. Braspanek's comes over the top. And Carly McCulloch in this position looks good, but she had to go on the long way round, which just cost her in the end. And the two Canadians came home strong. But a great ride from Braspanek's to take the win. That'll give her confidence going into the final. A throw for the line for third place. And this Kieran racing is so tight. During the racing, elbow to elbow. And then a throw for the line. So 4 or 5 years training all comes down to that. And we now have our 6 finalists for the women's Kieran later in the program.
Through Braspanek's, Mitchell and Genest, Shimlava, McCulloch and Heinz will race for the minor placings. Into the final, the women's Kieran go to Canadians, Lauriane Genest and Kelsey Mitchell, as well as two from the Ukraine, Lyubya Basova and Olena Starikova. Sinead Braspanek's from the Netherlands and Elise Andrews from New Zealand will be in there contesting for the gold medal.
Well, the Canadians have really stepped up in the women's Kieran. They've done so much talent scouting and it's now starting to pay off.
The riders just warming up for the next event on the men's Omnium. It's really, really testing for these riders. Test of stamina, endurance, tactical nous. The men's Omnium, after 2 of 4 races, sees 3 riders on 76 points. Jan Willem van Skip, Matthew Walls and Benjamin Thomas. Walls had won the scratch race early on. Van Skip did a good job in the tempo race. And Elia Viviani, the defending champion, is in a spot of bother here if he wants to defend his title and emulate the Team Pursuit teammates from Italy and take gold here.
Well, the winner of this elimination race will take 40 points. And I'm sure Elia Viviani knows this is the turning point if he wants to be in the medal hunt before the last race, the points race, which is one of his stronger events. But this is my actual favorite race of the Omnium, the elimination. It's so exciting. The last rider across the line being eliminated. So it's a race at the back of the peloton, not at the front.
Every 2 laps, the last rider gets eliminated. And they've each got devices on their bikes that'll light up if they are the last rider to indicate to them. As you can see it there on Benjamin Thomas's bike. And that'll be the signal that they are the last rider. They would hope not to see that. So it's basically the last rider standing wins the race.
Well, it's a race of endurance, that's for sure. You need to stay at the front, high speeds, and if you get caught at the back or on the inside of the track, it's about tactics to get out of the box and not be the last person across the line. We will see a very exciting race here for race three of the men's Omnium. So they've already raced two races, a lot of lactic acid and fatigue in the legs. And that's the new format at the Olympic Games in Tokyo, four events in one day. And this is the third event of the men's Omnium, the elimination.
The whistle for the third event in the men's Omnium, a four-event discipline. And this is the elimination race. Every two laps, the last rider will be eliminated. So it's a battle about staying away from the back of the race. Fascinating stuff.
Well, that's the start of the race. And we have the Australian trying to lead this out, Sam Welsford. So being at the front can be a good thing, but being low on the track can be a very dangerous thing. If riders come over the top at the last minute, you get boxed in. So it'll be this lap we'll see a rider eliminated. They'll be notified by a red flashing box which is on their handlebars. We already have a few problems. They're going to stop and neutralise the race, and that's what they've done. Two riders with mechanical problems off the start, so...
Well, they rolled off, and straight away there was the problem. Gavin Hoover.
He ran into one of the other officials who was holding a rider, and that's why the race is going to be restarted.
Yeah, the double pull of the starter's gun. That's Noreen Landis Tyson, the first woman judge president of an Olympic track meet, and under her auspices, the commissaires and judges will call this race and all the events.
So all the team managers that are holding their riders on the bottom of the track will be instructed now to move out of the way very quickly. Instead of just letting your rider go and stand there, they need to move back very quickly and out of the way. So a restart for the men's elimination race, which is a part of the Omnium, the third event.
Well, it really is a testing event, the Omnium. Puts the riders under incredible physical duress as well as mental stress in terms of working tactics and knowing exactly where they are in relation to their closest rivals.
Yeah, this is one of the races the riders will get most nervous about because they can get caught out. So it's not necessarily the strongest and fastest man could be out quite early if he's not paying attention. So it's one of those races that have to be mentally switched on the entire race.
So the riders will line up again in their designated positions, designated by the overall standings in the event. That's Jan Willem van Skip, Matthew Walls and Benjamin Thomas, the three of them are at the top of the standings after two events in the Omnium on 76 points. Nicholas Larson on 62. We have 40 points to the winner of this event. 38, 36, and as on we go down. It's Matthew Walls. And Skip, silver medalist the last 2 years in the World Championships in the Omnium.
Well, that looks like a face of confidence to me. Van Schip in a very good position, leading on the same points with two other riders after two races of the Omnium. Last chance to take a drink. You can see that box on the handlebars. That'll flash red if the rider needs to... If the rider's been eliminated and needs to leave the track, they have to obey what they see on that red, on that box that flashes red. Benjamin Thomas, one of the big favourites in the equal lead with Matthew Walls from Great Britain and Van Schip of the Netherlands.
They're under starter's orders. And away they go, the 20 riders in the men's Omnium, the third event of the four-event discipline on one day. This is the elimination race. Every two laps, a rider, the last rider in the field, will be eliminated. So it's a war of attrition at the back of the field. Unlike the other races, you don't want to be caught out at the back.
Well, the restart has gone smoothly to this point. The race is on.
It's all about avoiding the last position. At the moment, the South African David Maria is in trouble. They go through for the bell now. It's this lap that the last rider will be eliminated. And he's going to work really hard to get around Mark Downey, the Irishman. Also, there is the Austrian Müller down the bottom of the track.
Well, this is what can happen. David Marie, he needs to put the pressure on. He might just get the Switzerland right. No, but I think he's actually been eliminated. He's looking at his red box. Still in the race.
Yeah, it's Andreas Müller, the Austrian, who's been eliminated. The bell. It's relentless.
Some riders like to ride from the back there and just pip off one rider on the finish line, but you have to be extremely strong to be able to do that.
Well, the Austrian is still in the race. His
box is flashing.
Flashing, yeah. The yellow flag is being waved now.
That'll mean a neutralized lap, I think, until... Well, this is disappointing. Marie, his box is not flashing.
And now... Yeah, this referee's calling the Austrian Müller off, and Albert Maria is not continuing on the race. It has been neutralized.
Yeah, he's realized he's still in the race, so he is now accelerating to catch the peloton. The peloton has been asked to take the pressure off and get neutralized, but the race will start once Marie jumps back into the race. So the South African will take some height on the track.
And the race is underway again. Well, drama and twists and turns here.
Well, they're saying the front of the race is indeed the South African rider, David Marie.
Yeah, so he just rolled up and waited until the group caught him. So he's in a decent position now for... This last lap, it's Downey from Ireland who's going to get caught at the back here.
At Downey from Ireland, we'll see the box flashing. Not yet.
Mark Downey is out of the race.
And this lap, another rider will be eliminated. So we're looking at Kluger at the back and the rider from Belarus.
Kluger doesn't want to get caught too far back here. He's one of those who could be in contention for a medal, but he's safe now.
So it'll be the rider from Belarus, number 9, who is eliminated. Shakes his head. He's not happy. Now it's Kluger in the dangerous position at the back, and he's just gone on the inside as well. So they get the bell. The next time round, a rider will be eliminated. Kluger will hit the pedals down the back straight to improve his position.
Got work to do now, hasn't he?
Certainly is. He's got to keep looking behind him. I don't think he realizes that there was no riders behind him. Kluger will be out, so that's a big surprise. He's surprised there was no riders behind him. So he still thinks he's in the race, but he is not. There's the red flash. Roger Kluger is out. And now Larsen at the back is in trouble from Denmark.
Well, some of those. Larsen is fourth overall. He moves ahead now in the thick of it there. And it's the Polish rider, Szymon Chrzanok, who's in trouble, but who's going to go out there. It was so close.
Well, photo there. Well, it's the Polish rider. Yeah, Chrzanok, he's out. His red light's flashing. And they are sprinting again.
Oh, world champion goes out early. Battle gets tighter and tenser now. Olikakis on the inside. There's how close it was.
Well, now David Marie may be eliminated.
I think it will be South Africa's David Marie. The pride of Kroonstad goes out, unfortunately, but a brave ride so far. One event to go for him.
So the peloton is getting smaller and smaller as we now see the Spanish rider on the back. Just behind Kazakhstan, there's going to be a sprint. So the Spanish rider realizes now he's the last in line.
It's Torres, he's under pressure.
But it's the Greek rider on the inside who's in big trouble as well.
Yeah, yes. Yep. Polycarcus.
Polycarcus, number 30, is out that lap. Well, big whistles from the inside of the track saying there's a move coming and it's from the Spanish rider.
Torres, the bell again. He's moved from the back to the front. And suddenly it's Artem Zakharov under pressure at the back from Kazakhstan.
Now he's going on the inside. It's a dangerous place to go now. He's coming, trying to go around the outside. I don't think he's going to make it. No, so Ukraine is out.
So now Gavin Hoover slips back as Zakharov rolls and the field gets smaller and smaller.
Oh, it's Larson and Hoover. Sprint for the line. And Hoover of USA, they've still got one lap till they sprint. But it's Larson. Hoover comes around the outside. Now it's Larson in big trouble. And the Australian.
Niklas Larson trying to find a way through here. And he might just have got there ahead of the Japanese rider. And I think he is out. It is Aya Hashimoto, to the disappointment of the home crowd, goes out.
A good effort from the Japanese rider as we come up to another sprint lap. It's Larson and Welsved at the back.
Meanwhile, right at the front, Matthew Wells and Jan Willem van Schip have just kept a wonderful tempo. They're looking in very good form as the battle now.
Oh, it's going to be a tight battle, but it looks like it's going to be Welsved out, or will it be the New Zealand rider? It's on the inside, USA.
Yeah, Gavin Hoover, I think, is the man, the New Yorker, who goes out here. Here's Gavin Hoover. Have a look at how close that was. Thomas wasn't far away there either. The bell, and Larson is lurking dangerously close every lap here.
Yeah, he's riding a tactic from the back, hoping the riders on the inside get caught, which they do. It's now the Belgian rider in trouble.
Kenny DeKettler. It's going to be close, but this time it's Benjamin Thomas. I think you might be in trouble.
I think you might be right. One of the big favourites, the reigning world champion.
No, it's DeKettler. He did just the right thing there.
DeKettler on the inside. That's a dangerous place to be. But Benjamin Thomas will want to make his way a little bit further up the field. What's Larson going to do this time? He's got a long way to come around. Sam Welsford in a difficult position here. Larson, if he comes around, Sam Welsford, big trouble.
Oh, it's going to be tight, and Welsford, I think it is, who will lose out here. Yep, Sam Welsford goes out, the Australian.
Such an exciting race, the elimination race. One rider eliminated every lap, every second lap, so they get a bell now. Viviani's had a great race. Ooh, but it's the favourite, the Frenchman. And Larson at the back. One rider will be eliminated again this lap, the last rider across the line. Who will it be? Larson goes on the inside. Dangerous position.
Oh, and I think he is this time. Larson, the Dane, is out. So Larson goes. We've got Torres, we've got Van Skip, we've got Skier, the Swiss rider. Elia Viviani is there. So is Campbell Stewart, Matthew Walls, and Benjamin Thomas, the big hitters here.
Must say, I think this is a tactic from the British rider to try and eliminate the favourite from France. A late run from the great British rider.
I think he survived Thomas because Torres will go out. You're right, the bottom of the track is not where you want to be here. Clever tactics from Matthew Walls.
Yeah, very strategic. He's riding from the back, but we'll see him jump a bit forward. He's got the fast New Zealander in front of him as well. It's Campbell Stewart. Here he goes, down the back straight. From Great Britain, Matthew Walls. Will he get around the New Zealander? Yes, he does.
Thomas is the man who goes out there. The world champion is out, Benjamin Thomas. And now there are five left.
Van Schip looks like he's in really good form. That's a big disappointment for the Frenchman. Ella Viviani hasn't put a foot wrong in this race. So Van Schip leads it out at the back. It's now Matthew Wells in trouble.
Campbell Stewart, Matthew Wells.
And Stewart's in the box now and can't get out of that one. So Stewart is out that time from New Zealand.
Fifth it'll be. Last four, Van Schip, Ella Viviani. There's Campbell Stewart, former world champion. Out of the race. And now Van Schip, Viviani, Skip, and Walls.
Well, what can Walls do? Can he come around? It's going to be the long way, three wide. I don't think he'll do it. Oh, he does. And it's Van Schip. He didn't expect that, but he was riding a team, like a team's pursuit just on the front.
So, three riders left here. Thierry Skip, Ella Viviani.
And we're seeing attack now.
Walls goes.
Viviani on the wheel. Terry Shear, he's given up. He's given up.
He's not going to battle with these two.
So this is looking good for Ella Viviani because Matthew Walls hadn't realised that he didn't really need to sprint that one. So they're on an neutralised lap. No one will be out this lap around, but the next one is the finish of the race. So one lap to go.
So Walls and Ella Viviani, who's looked very, very composed in this race. Walls goes. Viviani's got the sprint. Walls out the saddle, but Viviani eases into the lead here. Ella Viviani, the defending champion, will win the elimination race. That's hugely impressive. Walls, very, very composed, takes second.
Well, a big fan favourite, Ella Viviani. He's put himself back in the race. A disappointing two rounds for Viviani, but in the third race he's turned it all around, moved himself up the leaderboard, and the points race is certainly going to be one that he's going to enjoy. So a little smile to the crowd. He hasn't given up on the Olympic dream. He's so proud to wear that Italian jersey.
Absolutely wonderful. He has a very, very busy year on the road, Ella Viviani, but still just loves this. 81 career wins. He's raced 54 days on the road this year.
Yeah, which is a huge program at this point of the year, having to fit in your track. So Matthew Walls there.
He heads the leaderboard now by 4 points. Walls ahead of Van Schip by 4 points. And then it's Benjamin Thomas, 8 points adrift of Walls. It's so close. This is the culmination of the elimination race.
And how comfortable did Viviani look that entire race? His positioning was absolutely superb. He didn't have to ride on the front. He made his space. You see, this is the replay of the kick when he comes off and comes around Matthew Walls. There was nothing he could do. Ella Viviani takes the win of the third race of the men's Omnium, the elimination race.
Confirming the result of the elimination race, round three of four in the men's Omnium. Ella Viviani ahead of Matthew Walls, Thierry Skuur, Jan Willem van Schip, Campbell Stewart, and Benjamin Thomas. First elimination was that of Andreas Müller of Austria. How does that affect the overall Omnium standings after three rounds? One to go. Walls just 4 points clear of Jan Willem van Schip, Benjamin Thomas, Thierry Skuur, Nicholas Larsen, Ella Viviani up from 11th to 6th place. And it can all change and will all change in the points race because every point counts in that event. It really is going to be thrilling.
Well, some of the most exciting racing we've seen tonight in the women's Kierans, the men's Omnium. And we are now back to the men's sprint, the quarterfinals.
The field for the men's sprint quarterfinals. Race two, Hoogeland against Vigier. Jeffrey Hoogeland has looked so, so strong all the way through. What can Sebastian Vigier do here to try and unsettle this Dutch powerhouse?
Well, I'm not quite sure there's anything he can do. He's trying the death stare. Hughlin not interested.
Hughlin won the first round. A win here. And it puts him into the semi-finals.
Yeah, not much, I think, can be done to beat Hughland when he's in this type of form, but we'll see what Vigier can do. Hughland decides to ride from the front. Keep an eye on his component.
How do you beat a man who's been in such good form? He's looked untroubled, never under any pressure at all.
Well, pushing him long, it's not going to really help because he just gets faster and faster. Trying to jump around him, very, very hard as well. You just have to catch him off guard. That's the only way.
We saw it happen in two of the quarterfinals. Riders getting caught off guard off the last put the bank on the last quarter. Here goes Hughland and Vigier. The bell, the final lap for these two in the second heat of the quarterfinals, and Jeffrey Hughland, the Dutchman, he's under a bit more pressure here from Vigier, and Vigier's pushing hard, but Hughland will take it and take it again with ease. He's through to the semi-finals.
Yeah, Vigier, he did everything right. He rode a very good tactical race, but nothing fazes this man, Jeffrey Hughland. He is on a mission. He hasn't been unsettled once through all of the rounds.
Another step towards the middle rounds for Jeffrey Hughland.
He
has looks over.
Yeah, he thinks, okay, I do need to put a bit of pressure on the pedals here. Keep him on the hip. So that's the first time we've actually seen him under a little bit of pressure. Vigier takes a bit of height on the track so he can get some speed down the track. Comes back onto the wheel. But there's a big difference once you step off and you try to come around. It's a huge difference in power output. And this man's just too strong, Jeffrey Hughland.
Confirming the result of race two. So Jeffrey Hughland wins the best of three by winning both heats and goes through to the semi-finals. Our second heat, the second race, and a final opportunity for the defending champion, Jason Kenny, to rescue his Olympic dream of making it another sprint victory here. But he's got his work cut out because this man, Harry Labrosen, beat him fairly comfortably in the first heat, first race of this heat.
Jason Kenny looking a little bit more determined this time, confident with his race plan. But Lavreyesen, one of the in-form Dutchmen, it's going to be very, very hard to beat. I never count Jason Kenny out. He's got so much experience, race experience. I don't think he's quite the fastest of the two at the moment, but he's a very, very smart and tactful rider.
Strategy and tactics that Jason Kenny has in spades here. Labrosen is not a double world champion for nothing. He's been there as well and has shown through the rounds that he is absolutely in superb form here. Kenny's going for a long drag now.
Well, that's what I said. He was confident with his plan, and his plan was to go long, catch Labrosen by surprise. Labrosen just has to stay calm. And I think he's going to get this one back.
Kenny has 5.5 lengths as they take the bell now. Labrosen has to show his skills now. The world champion up the saddle on that back straight. He'll come off the bend. And Kenny has run out of steam. His tactic didn't work. It's Harry Labrosen who goes through. And Jason Kenny's reign as Olympic champion in the sprint is over.
He had to do something, Jason Kenny, and he decided to take it long. But the informed Dutch didn't panic, just knew it was a possibility that that could happen. Very proud. As we look at the slow-mo, the power of this man when he comes past Jason Kenny. And Jason Kenny basically sat up and gave up the minute he saw Lauriasen come into his peripheral vision. Lauriasen just too fast.
Well, he had to try something, as you suggested there, Shalinda. He went long, went early, and in hope more than expectation. And Lauriasen is in peak form at the moment and wasn't going to be caught out by that one.
I'm quite confident that we'll see a two-up final with the Dutch. Two Dutch, they're so strong.
Harry Lauriasen beats Jason Kenny in both the races in the quarterfinals and goes through to the semifinals. Rolling up to the start for race two, heat three in the men's sprint. In the quarterfinals, it's Max Levy. Well, this man, vastly experienced, fourth Olympic Games for him. And Jack Collin from Great Britain won the opening race. Silver at the World Championships in 2018 for Collin. Away they go in the second race of Heat 3 in the men's sprint quarterfinals. Jack Collin is 1-0 up over Max Levy.
Yeah, Max Levy, he's got to do something here to stay in contention. But Jack Collin took the first race of these two. Let's see what Max Levy can do. He's riding it from the back. Collin wants to be at the back. That's why he's slowing down. He's trying to force Levy to go past.
Well, they've got to go at walking speed, and there's a commissaire walking trackside there just to indicate the speed with which she's walking. Therefore, they must go at least that fast or slowly.
Yeah, if they stop, they've only got 30 seconds they're allowed to stop for in a track stand. Well, Levy just trying to put pressure on Collin.
Got to try something here, the German, because he doesn't win this. He is out. Trying to find a way down. Collin, very tactical here.
Yeah, a very, very frustrating place for Levy to be in. He can't get past him. And they both get the advantage of the banking. So Collin in the box position here. What can Levy do? Can he come off the wheel, give him some length, and then make a run at him?
Levy's not making much ground now. Collin is coming off the bend. And Jack Collin will take the win for Great Britain and go through to the semi-finals. Impressive tactics from the British rider.
Yeah, it's a tactic we used to see Victoria Pendleton use against enemies. Hold her up on the fence. And Great Britain have the perfect tactics. Collin, happy with that. Oh, time to zip up. Ready to play as they roll off the line. Levy versus Collin. Collin puts Levy on the fence, holds him high, and then uses the advantage of the banking to pick up his pace and put some distance between himself and Levy. And Levy was in a position to run back at him, but just could not close that gap. Collin in top form. And we'll move through to the semi-final.
Jack Collin joins Harry Lauriasen and Jeffrey Hoogeland in the semi-final and perhaps takes the baton from Jason Kenny, who's out of the competition at this round. Collin confirmed beating Max Levy 2-0.
Well, we just see the managers there making sure the straps are as tight as they can possibly be, and sometimes so tight that the feet are numb. But they need to be very, very tight. The amount of power these riders put on the pedals. There we see the president of the UCI, David Lapartier, got the box seat here at the Velodrome. Just enjoying the racing until he'll do the formalities for the medal ceremonies.
Denis Dimitriev, a five-time medalist at the World Championships, one of those gold in 2017, and he's up against Nicholas Paul from Trinidad and Tobago. What an opportunity here to reach for glory for Trinidad and Tobago. The final heat, race two in the men's sprint. And it's Nicholas Paul of Trinidad and Tobago up against the Russian Olympic Committee's Denis Dmitriev, the 2017 world champion. Paul, the fastest man on the bike in the world. He holds the world record, 9.100.
And he took the first race of two in this competition against Dmitriev. He was just too fast and strong. But Dmitriev sitting behind now, he has a lot of experience. Can he catch the strong rider by surprise? But Nicholas Paul has it all in control from the front at the moment. Dmitriev wants to push him long. I don't think that tactic's going to help. Nicholas Paul too strong, too fast. Dmitriev just trying to put pressure on him to go faster. But this man can get faster and faster. Here comes Dmitriev. That's his move. That's his move to get around. Catch him by surprise. But the strong man from Trinidad and Tobago, he was able to keep the sprint line. And it may be all over now for Dmitriev.
He's bringing it home, Nicholas Paul here. Dmitriev, the bronze medalist from Rio, is out. Nicholas Paul gets the wave from the Russian Olympic Committee rider. And Trinidad and Tobago have a man going through to the semi-finals in the shape of Nicholas Paul. Glory beckons for this rider.
Yeah, he's so strong, and we haven't seen him go head-to-head with the Dutchman yet. It's going to be a very exciting semi-final in the men's sprint. We just see them on the start line pumping themselves up. Their pre-race rituals. They go off the line, a serious space from Dmitriev. And he made this move trying to catch Nicholas Paul by surprise. But Nicholas Paul strong enough to get him on the hip. And that's when it was all over. Dmitriev gives salute to the fastest man in the world.
Yeah, not much you can do about that. He was too strong, so Dmitriev's hopes of repeating his bronze in Rio are over.
Well, great racing we've seen in the men's sprints.
And confirming those through to the semi-finals, two Dutchmen, Hoogeland and Lebrasen, Carlin and Paul. What a race in prospect in those semi-finals.
Well, not too many big upsets in the men's sprint. Yep. They were the strongest of the competition before going into the semi-finals. Now we get into the real finals. First, the women's Kieran. It is the race for 7th to 12th, and after that, we'll see the gold medal race.
Well, it's been a long journey for these riders getting to the finals. And, well, these six riders would have hoped to be riding a little bit later in the day, but they are now riding for 7th to 12th. Carly McCullough, Zhong Chan Chi, Emma Hines, EYG, Daniela Gashola, there she is, and Daria Chimleva alongside her. Here's Zhong Chan Chi.
Let's see this ripped skin suit from the Mexican rider. She came down after the finish line of her last race. But she'll line up for the prestigious finals, 7th to 12th place in the women's Kieran. Carly McCulloch disappointed not to be in the race for the gold medal.
The gun for the start of the final for 7th to 12th place in the women's Kieran. And the Durney rolls past the riders and they will form up behind them. It is Carly McCulloch, Zhong Chan Chi, Emma Heinze, Li Weiji, Daniela Gashola and Darius Mleba, the riders in this race. And Emma Heinze, we haven't seen her do this at any stage in the series of races. She's taken up position right behind the Durney.
Yeah, she wants to stay out of trouble. We've seen so much confusion at the back of the race in the previous heats of the women's Kieran. It's Hines that's behind the Durney. Following her is Carly McCulloch from Australia.
It's the world champion is Emma Hines, but she's not going to have a chance to become an Olympic champion, racing for the minor placings here. So it's Heinze, then it's Carly McCulloch, Li Waiji, Zhong Zhongqi, then it's Daria Shimleva, and the Mexican, Daniela Gaxola, who makes a move from the back as the journey will pull off very shortly. And the racing's on.
And Gaxola from Mexico. She's had a fall, but she's on the front. Hines behind McCulloch. They are looking for 7th to 12th place in this final in the Kieran.
Go through now with Zhong Zhongqi from China on the top of the track. Hines and McCulloch in a wheel. Long charge here from Zhong Zhongqi. Gaxola has work to do for the back, but Zhong Zhongqi from China is in a great position. Emma Heinze is marking her every move.
Well, Heinze trying to come over the top, and I think she does. Carly McCulloch as well.
Li Waiji on the top of the track there, McCulloch as well, but Heinze is looking strong. Li Waiji's going to push hard, but Emma Heinze will take the win.
Yeah, strong ride from Emma Heinze to take 7th place at the Olympic Games.
So, Heinze, Li Waiji, Carly McCulloch, Shimleva, Gaxola, Zhong Zhongqi. Well, she was the world champion in Berlin and home track last year. So not quite the result she was hoping for.
As we see the replay here coming down the home straight, Emma Heinze from Germany throws for the line to take 7th place. Kieran Racing changed so much now. The Durny brings them up to 45 kilometres per hour with 3 laps to go. So you have to have a very long sprint. You can see the positions change in the very final 20 metres, 10 metres of the race. The German coach just wishing that Emma Heinze was actually in the ride-off for the gold.
The first gold medal of day 4 at the Itzu Velodrome to be decided in the women's Kieran. This is the start. This for the final. 2 Canadians, Lauriane Genest and Kelsey Mitchell. And it's Janet Brespanix of the Netherlands, Ellis Andrews from New Zealand, Lubia Basova from the Ukraine, and Olena Starikova from Ukraine. Well, this is a field, and what an opportunity beckons here. A new Olympic champion will be crowned. Ellis Andrews is 21, fifth at the World Championships. Lebris Panix, the 30-year-old, silver at the World Championships in 2015. Kelsey Mitchell, the bronze at the Pan American Championships in 2019. Lubyov Basova, fifth in Rio. And the European champion, Elena Starikova, who's shown great form thus far.
Be anyone's final now, just moments before the Durny winds up and comes past the riders at 25 kilometers per hour. He'll build it up to 45 kilometers per hour over 3 laps, and then the race will be on for the gold medal.
The gun goes for the gold medal in the women's Kieran, and the riders line up behind the Durny. Starikova, Basova, Mitchell and Genese, Brespanix and Andrews. These are the riders contesting for the gold medal here in Tokyo 2020.
Well, the 2 riders of Ukraine, they went first and second behind the Durny, and both went through to the final, so they're taking that position again. It'll be interesting to see if one rider is actually sacrificing for the other. There's 2 Canadians in the race as well. Brespanix from Netherlands, and great to see the New Zealander in there as well, Elise Andrews.
Kelsey Mitchell is the 3rd rider, the 1st of the Canadians in this. Olena Starikova is right behind the Durny. Basova in the blue helmet for Ukraine. And it's Mitchell Brisbane's Andrews. And the second of the Canadians, Janest.
Well, I think Kelsey Mitchell has been one of the fastest riders. But Durney will come off. And the race is on the last three laps.
Very tactical here as Tarikova is looking over his shoulder. No one's going yet.
Kelsey Mitchell decides she needs to pass Tarikova. Going the long way round. Brisbane's in a good position here.
Tarikova goes through the line. They've got two to go. Kelsey Mitchell on the front. Brisbane's on her wheel. Elise Andrews like to go from long. She's on the top of the track here for New Zealand.
A very long way for the New Zealand to come around. It's Brisbane's and Kelsey Mitchell. The New Zealand are now into second place. Elise Andrews, it's looking good for the Dutch woman out in front.
Brisbane's and Andrews, who's it going to be? Here they go. It's Brisbane's who's going to take gold for the Netherlands. Andrews gets silver for New Zealand. A brilliant, brilliant ride. And it's Janes who takes the bronze for Canada. Well, glory for the Netherlands. What a ride.
Brisbane's, more Dutch power. The Dutch know there's more to come. They are absolutely delighted with that gold medal.
Well, they are. And so is Elise Andrews with her silver medal for New Zealand. What a ride by the 21-year-old. But there is your gold medalist in the women's Kieran. Janay Brisbane's silver medalist is Elise Andrews, who's absolutely delighted with that.
Well, it's so tough with funding in New Zealand. It means so much to be a medalist at the Olympic Games. Takes a lot of pressure off. It means a lot. There's the third place Canadian rider. It's Lauriane Gentz, but Brisbane's cannot believe it.
Well, what a games the Dutch are having here. We have another look at this race.
Yeah, I thought Kelsey Mitchell there from Canada would have been a force to reckon with, but she did get boxed in. Brisbane's came around the two Ukraine riders. Elise Andrews may have wanted to stay on the wheel a little bit longer before trying to come out. But what a delight for those riders. Gold, silver and bronze. It's Brisbane's, the New Zealander, Elise Andrews, and from Canada, Lauriane Gentz. So the Dutch are really showing their power this year at the Tokyo Olympics on the track sprint events.
Well, fantastic. She's absolutely blown away by the performance here, as is this young lady from New Zealand. Superb riding all the way through. She's been aggressive. She's taken it from the front. And confirmation of the gold medal to Netherlands, Janay Brisbane's, with Elise Andrews taking the silver for New Zealand and Lauriane Gentz from Canada, the bronze medalist in the women's Kieran. A look here
at the replay of the men's sprint, because it was the rider from Trinidad and Tobago that crossed the line first, but he has been relegated. So Dmitriev took that round, which means we go to a final race three decider between Dmitriev and Nicholas Paul.
So
the celebrations continue for the Dutch.
Men's sprint quarterfinals up next, and it's a deciding race in the men's sprint because Nicholas Paul was relegated in round two due to leaving the sprinting lane, and Denis Dmitriev has an opportunity to salvage something here and get into the race for the medals. I'll say that in both those races, he really look as though he had it in him to beat Nicholas Paul. But there's nothing like being given a third or a late opportunity to find yourself the energy and the motivation to take the win.
Yeah, well, that's Dimitriev just selecting his position on the start line. So too high on the track goes to Dimitriev. Position number one will go to Nicholas Paul.
The judges will look very closely. They do have video cameras all over the track, keeping an eye on riders' lines and behavior. So that's how they would have picked that one up, and hence Nicholas Paul's relegation.
Yeah, a pure decision from the commissaires, because we saw the riders happy with the result when they crossed the line, congratulating each other, and fair play. But the commissaires decided that Paul Nicholas came out of the sprinter's lane. Nicholas Paul, should I say. And now they go to the deciding race. Get those shoe covers on properly over the tightened straps. Look how big that chain ring is. They are pushing some massive gears here.
Denis Dimitriev from the Russian Olympic Committee has been handed a reprieve, an opportunity to race himself into the semi-finals against this man, Nicholas Paul from Trinidad and Tobago. He's shown great form throughout the competition.
Oh, Dimitriev very focused now that he's got another chance against the fastest man in the world here from Trinidad and Tobago, Nicholas Paul. He will be somewhat upset about having to do another ride. Just means that he has to play it really safe, even if it means doing it the hard way. This could be a huge upset if it's unsettling for Nicholas Paul. He takes the lead from Dimitriev.
Deciding race in this men's quarterfinal. Dimitriev behind Paul. Trinidad and Tobago in front. Russian Olympic Committee at the back. Paul won the first and second race, is relegated due to leaving the line in the second race, hence the decider here. Just keeping an eye is Nicholas Paul. Dimitriev starting to wind it up.
Yeah, Dimitriev trying to pull Nicholas Paul high on the track so he can try and duck under him. And that's what he does, but not quite fast enough. He does force the rider to go long. It's what he tried in the last round. Will he get over the top? Yes, he does.
This is going to be interesting. Whoa, Nicholas Paul is going to lose this. And Denis Dimitriev is going to ride himself into the semi-finals.
It's what I expected, that there'd be an upset. When you go to round three decider, you are a little bit shaken. And Dimitriev, he's been in this position. He's been racing so many years, so much experience.
Well, great disappointment for the man from Trinidad and Tobago, who thought he'd won two clean races, but then it was the commissaires who picked up that he left the racing line, and this man handed a reprieve, and he's taken it. The commissaires are having a look at this.
Well, from our first initial view, it looked like it was pretty clean, because once Dimitriev got into that sprinter's lane, we shouldn't see Nicholas Paul enter into it. So we'll see a slow-mo now replay. The aggression, Dimitriev on the start line. And Nicholas Paul. So.
Yeah, he nearly nipped the wheel, and that's why he pulled out there.
Yeah, he's right, a mistake there. So I think that result will stand. Commissaire still looking very closely at the video footage, but Dimitriev looks to go through to the semi-final. Massive disappointment for Nicholas Paul.
Well, the young man from Trinidad Tobago, it's been an amazing Olympic experience for him. So their confirmation that Denis Dimitriev is through to the semi-finals. The Wiley experience, 5 World Championship medals. And he took his opportunity here at the key moment, diving in and managing to get ahead. And it unsettled the Trinidad and Tobago rider. And he takes the applause.
Well, it's the Olympic Games. Anything can happen. Dimitriev will be very satisfied. You can see how much the legs hurt. He can't get down the stairs. He needs to take a seat. Denis Dimitriev from the Russian Olympic Committee goes through to the semi-final of the men's sprint. And here are the results of the men's sprint quarterfinals.
So Hoogeland and Lebrasen through, the Dutch looking so powerful. Jack Carlin of Great Britain and Denis Dimitriev, the Russian Olympic Committee, will contest the men's sprint semi-finals, but that won't be for today's program. Dimitriev's got a little time to recover. The final event in the men's Omnium is the points race, and this is an enthralling spectacle because it's all come down to the points race now.
It's going to be super exciting, this race, and also very confusing, but let's just focus on the points race to start with.
That's the overall standings in the men's Omnium after 3 races. So little in it. 8 points between the top 3, and then Skjer, Larsen and Viviani still in the mix. Zakharov down in 11th place. Torres Hashimoto is there for Japan. So, 25 kilometers, 100 laps. Points earned for sprints every 10 laps. And the final sprint is double, and those points are 5, 3, 2, and 1 every 10 laps, and 20 points for lapping the field.
Yeah, which I think is going to make this race really exciting. I think riders like Viviani, they're going to want to take laps and get maximum points, because all the points gained in this points race count towards the final points tally for the Omnium. So they have a total at the moment, and now every single point earned in this points race goes towards that final Omnium position. So we are watching a gold medal race right here, right now.
Yeah, and so as we're going along, you know that every point, so it'll affect the standings in real time. So riders have to be so aware of what's going on around them here.
They'll definitely be keeping an eye on their coaches to get an indication of what points they're on, and the scoreboard as well.
The final event in the men's Omnium is underway. The 4th event of a really busy day for these 20 riders. And it is the points race. And the medals will be decided in this race. 25 kilometers, 100 laps. Points earned for sprints every 10 laps. 5, 3, 2 and 1 point for the top 5. Double points for the final sprint. And 20 points for lapping the field. We're underway now in the points race in the men's Omnium. The overall leader at the moment, overall after 3 events, Matthew Walls. Jan Willem van Skip is just 4 points behind him on 110. And then Benjamin Thomas, the world champion, is on 106 points. So there's so little between them.
And a little mention to the reigning champion from Rio, Elia Viviani. He sits in 6th position with 82 points versus the leader on 114, which is Matthew Walls from Great Britain. Big job to do for the Italian if he wants to win the Omnium here at the Olympic Games. Roger Kluger goes out hard.
Well, Kluger, the German, is a real powerhouse, is Roger Kluger. And he's taken with him Yevheny Karolyakov, the scratch race world champion from last year from Belarus. They're looking to try and maybe take an early lap here. Working together because Karolyok allowed to go through by Kluger. They'll try and take a lap.
Well, they've got half a lap already. Within the first four laps, the peloton not too concerned. There are going to be a lot of laps taken in this race.
Well, it's a real test of endurance, this event. 100 laps on the final event of four on the day. So the strongest all-round rider will be crowned the champion today. No question about that. They're making good ground. The group is splitting up, and Tuga and Karliok are closing in.
Yeah, just some speed now shown at the front of the peloton. And it was New Zealand who put down the first pressure, but it stalled again.
Yeah, Roger Kluger needs his points. He's way down the standings. Down in 15th place. Emilio Viviani positioned right at the back of this field for the time being as well, the defending champion.
Yeah, well, there's two laps until the sprint. Are the two riders going to make contact before that? My guess is they'll try to time it and hang off the back so they get the 5 and 3 points for the sprint, and then they'll try to make contact.
The bell.
And a little bit of communication there. Roger Kluger has decided to catch the bunch before the sprint, take the 20 points. They've made contact, which means the winner of this sprint will go to...
Well, Volikakis was there with Benjamin Thomas.
One more lap as they come through. It looks like Benjamin Thomas will take the 5 points.
And he
takes those points and swings up the track.
Giving it
to the Belarusian,
yeah,
because he hadn't made contact,
yes,
with the bunch.
So Yoheni Karliok has taken those 5 points. 3 to Benjamin Thomas, 2 to Gavin Hoover, the United States.
So an interesting tactic of the rider from Belarus who makes it back into the peloton. So also gains 25 points.
Willem van Schip, there's confirmation of those points. And Matthew Walls.
He's applying pressure to try and break this up. Ella Viviani not interested in taking it on. Swings up the track at second wheel.
And Walls puts in an attack now, and going with him is Hoover.
Well, a strong attack from Walls.
Yes. Roger Kluger. The initial lap.
That's Van Schip from the peloton trying to close it down.
Confirming that Karliok has taken the 20 points as well. That's the pair who... initiated the first attack, Kluger and Karliok. Indicating that Matthew Walls was the front of the race and Gavin Hoover is with him as the bunch behind, or almost half a lap behind.
Yeah, and Gavin Hoover just making contact with Matthew Walls now. They are the lead of the race. They're half a lap chasing down the peloton, wanting to get those 20 points for a lap. But now Matthew Walls not getting help from Hoover. He's only along for the ride. That might cause them problems. Hoover saying he's got nothing in there, leaving it all up to Walls. And that has wiped a little bit of pace off the two out in front. Here they are, Matthew Walls and Hoover from USA. They will most certainly take the points for this sprint lap.
Hoover was in 7th place, now 8th place in the overall standings prior to this. There's this front of the race.
So they take the 5 and 3 points, and then they make contact and take another 20 points.
So that's the tactic of just holding off until the come round of the sprint lap, and ensuring you benefit from those sprint points as well. So Matthew Walls goes to the top of the standings now, having taken the lap and 5 points. 139 points. He's 39 ahead of Jan Willem van Schip. So Benjamin Thomas, the Frenchman, the world champion. There's Gavin Hoover.
Yeah.
Albert Torres on the front four. Spain swings off and Dani and then Kluger and Elia Viviani holding off for the time being. Eight laps to go to the sprint.
Yeah, a little bit of a lull in the peloton. No one wanting to do too much work at the moment. The points race is generally sprinted very hard every 10 laps, but then there's the element of just waiting and then taking a lap, which gives you 20 points instead of 5. And there's attack now from the New Zealand rider.
It's confirmation of the standings as they are now in between after two laps, and Campbell Stewart goes off the front for New Zealand. Walls is quite happy to let him go. Stewart 79 points at the moment, so quite some distance off the 139 of Matthew Walls.
Sometimes that can play in the advantage that the really strong riders are not interested in chasing it. Campbell Stewart out in front now. He's only got a quarter of a lap advantage.
So, bottom of the track, Larson rolls up. Elia Viviani, the defending champion. What's he got in store for this race?
No doubt he's going to try something during this race, but it's still Campbell Stewart out in front for New Zealand. And Matthew Wall from Great Britain, he's really the man in control here as he's leading the Omnium.
So there's the lead, the referee just showing where the lead is, and it's with Campbell Stewart. He is likely to come take a lap, but again, it's two laps to go to the sprint. There's the bell.
Yeah, he'll no doubt want to take those 5 points. He's just backing off the pedals a little bit now, hoping to stay leader of the race until he takes those 5 points. Now he has to work hard to take contact with the back of the peloton. He's working really hard. The peloton know what his tactics are. They don't want him to make contact and take those 20 points. Very hard work for Campbell Stewart at the moment.
Meanwhile, Benjamin Thomas, Nicholas Larson, Terry Scher hoovered up the remaining points, 3, 2, and 1 in that order.
Well, you can see Campbell Stewart just making contact now as we see an attack. Oh, very short-lived. So 20 points for Campbell Stewart of New Zealand as he makes contact at the back of the peloton, plus that 5 points he got in the sprint.
And that vaults Campbell Stewart up to fourth place on the virtual race at the moment on 104 points. The lead is still with Matthew Walls on 139. Then it's Benjamin Thomas on 112.
And the big move coming from Elia Viviani, the reigning Olympic gold medalist in the Omnium.
We've been wondering when this would happen, and the Italian has gone like a rocket off the front. Roger Kluger is putting his ears back, and the man who initiated the early attack with him, Karoliok, is on his wheel as well.
Well, this is what we said from Elia Viviani. He's one of the marked men, so when he attacks, he's going to have the whole peloton jumping. He has no choice but just continue on now, but the peloton are not going to let this happen for Elia Viviani. They are determined. Well, he's continuing on. He rolls up the track now. He realizes it's going to be too much of a big ask.
He saw who was behind him as well. Roger Kluger is a real powerhouse. Shut that one down, but he might see an ally in Roger Kluger now.
Absolutely, the three of them have got together. They may be able to take a lap as the peloton have a moment of rest.
Well, Karoliok is a scratch race world champion from Berlin in 2020, so he knows what it's about in bunch racing. He flicks his elbow and asks Roger Kluger to go through, which he does. Viviani, and now they're starting to work well.
Yeah, they're half a lap up now, so a lot of pain on the faces in the peloton. Matthew Walls takes a turn. He knows that it's a dangerous move.
The bell for their leading trio. The sprint on the next lap.
So Viviani now trying to come around for the 5 points. Can he get around Kluger? Yes, he can. He takes the 5 points. Elia Viviani. Now they'll start working together again to try and take a lap and gain 20 more points.
Doesn't he make it look so easy, Elia Viviani there? Really, really impressive. who just swings off, and Karaliok and Viviani will pull. Willy De Ketelaere leads the chase. Then it's Hoover, and South Africa's David Maria is going really well here in the final race. What an opportunity for this man. Coming to race here at the Olympics, and he's showing great mettle. Meanwhile, Kluger, Karaliok from Belarus, and Viviani on the front.
Well, they gain time and then they lose time, but for Ella Viviani, it's not a big bad thing because he wants to get the sprint points with another three laps to go.
Just it's coming back slowly but surely, the group. They're working well together, this trio.
Yeah, Van Skip and Larsen are doing most of the work on the peloton.
Roger Kluger, so powerful. He's had a very busy year on the road, 56 race days this year. Kluger did both the Giro and the Tour de France. Didn't finish each of them, but did over a dozen days in both. But, that's what these men do.
So much endurance, these guys out in front just swapping off turns, just holding a steady half a lap lead. Peloton has split into two.
Pace is high, and now they will start looking at the sprint and the catch, this trio.
Yeah, they can see the back of the second part of the peloton, so that will give them some encouragement. Next lap, they'll hear the bell. Constant little moves from the peloton as these three stay out in front.
There's the bell for Roger Kluger, Yoni Karaliok of Belarus, and Elia Viviani, the Italian and defending champion.
Yeah, here he goes, comes off the wheel. He wants to try and come around the two of them to take those 5 points again. And then he'll start thinking about trying to make that lap and gain 20 points. There he goes.
It's a masterful display by Elia Viviani at the moment, the defending champion. He's putting real pressure on Matthew Walls, the man who's been leading thus far.
Well, he did a massive turn and hoped that Roger Kluger could close it. But it'll be after this lap. The minor points are taken by Matthew Walls that the peloton may sit up. And they get a chance to catch. So Roger Kluger just catching the peloton now for 20 points. That puts Ella Viviani in a good position as well. They're trying to hang off the back. They're trying to take another five laps and not make the catch. They don't want to make the catch. They've had the discussion.
This will be the second time they do this. They're just going to try and hang off the back here. Viviani, Kluger, and Karaliok.
Well, it's a hard way to do it, and at some point, if they're getting too tired, they have to make the catch, and they've done that now. 20 points to those three riders.
That vaults Elia Viviani into second place overall.
He's still got a massive job to do to catch the leader, Matthew Walls of Great Britain.
Yeah, he's got 28 points behind him. Benjamin Thomas on the same number of points as Viviani, 112.
Just past the halfway point here in this points race.
And the Belarusian has gone on his own now. Yohuni Karaliok. And Sam Welsford goes with him, or chases him anyway. There's a bit of action behind because Kenny De Ketelaere, the Belgian's put his head down to try and join the group.
Van Skip tries to close that gap, and he has on his wheel Benjamin Thomas.
Welsford and Karaliokas. We have a look at the overall standings there as they happen now. 140 to Walls. Viviani 112. Same as Benjamin Thomas. Van Skip 110 and Campbell Stewart 104. Remember, double points on the final lap.
Very, very important, the final lap. So they're in a sprint lap at the moment. Matthew Walls takes it out from the front for Great Britain. Ella Viviani in second. Will he try to come off the wheel, or will he save some energy for a counter-attack? I think he's happy to stay on the wheel.
So, another five to Walls. Viviani closes the gap, but Walls moves further away each time. So it's going to be a fascinating battle as they close in. They ease off a fraction after that sprint and look around. Viviani, Benjamin Thomas, Matthew Walls, Jan-Willem van Schip. We haven't seen him yet. He's been on the back, on the front of the chase group for most of the race. Now he goes, the Dutchman. They're having such a fantastic day here at Tokyo, a fantastic week at the track. Perhaps he can make it more glory. Well, Great Britain are looking for their first gold medal of this year's games.
They're looking very much in control with Matthew Wells of the gold medal in the Omnium at this point. Biggest threat comes from Ella Viviani. However, he would have to take a lap and more to catch Matthew Wells.
A little bit of a lull at the moment as Spain's Albert Torres goes off the front, or tries to. Kenny de Ketelaere, the veteran Belgian, phenomenal six-day racer, rolls up the bank, and they all look around again. 36 laps to go of this 100 test of endurance, stamina and strategy all the way around.
And Matthew Wells just taking control of the race. He knows the gold medal is only 35 laps away. We see the Australian come past with pace now. It's Sam Welsford putting in an attack. Van Schip chasing it down.
Four to go to the next sprint. Welsford goes. South Africa's David Maria is going to try and join him. Bold move by this man. He looks over his shoulder and he sees the peloton just easing, and here's an opportunity.
Well, it's been a great race for the South African to this point, but can he get across to Sam Welsford?
Welsford looking very strong. Just hanging in is David Maria's. Welsford's keeping the gap. He'll come around to take the bell.
So one more lap for Sam Welsford, the Australian, to gain that 5 points. Will he continue after that and try and take a lap? It all depends on what the peloton's doing. He's going to have them in sight this lap.
Well, can he keep it going? He'll take the points. And David Maria of South Africa picks up the 3 points for second place on that lap. Well done.
And 2 points to Elia Viviani.
Welsford continues. Maria swings up and Torres takes up the chase together with Viviani, Thomas and Walls.
They're looking very confident. Walls really in control.
Viviani looks over his shoulder as he crosses the line here and sees what's happening behind him. He sees Campbell Stewart putting his head down and coming across to try and join them with Gavin Hoover of the United States. Stewart's a danger man. He's in fifth place overall. He's a danger to Elia Viviani because he's 13 points behind Viviani. Walls is well clear at the moment, 145 points. With Viviani on 117.
It could look like a race for the silver medal here because Matthew Walls has not missed a beat in this race, the rider from Great Britain.
Very controlled. Took an early lap and has consolidated that throughout.
Well, there's only two more sprints left. The final sprint, double points, so it'll be 10 points for the final sprint.
And right now, it is Walls on 145. 117 is the next closest rider.
So Viviani on 117 in second place, and just behind him, Benjamin Thomas from France on 115 points. It's very close. Van Schip on 111. So the gold medal looks pretty secure, but then it's all very, very close.
Van Skip's the one who's missed out, really. He's only picked up one sprint point. There's Wells. Walls, at least, confirmation of his situation. Very, very controlled. He's marked his closest rivals very well as Viviani drops down behind Van Skip and Kenny de Kettler now. And Benjamin Thomas won't let him go too far, neither will Matthew Walls.
So Van Skip leading from the Netherlands with a lap to go. Viviani in second place. And it is the Frenchman coming around to take the points. Viviani on the wheel. Can Viviani come back? Going to be a tough ask.
Viviani, he has won all his sprints very comfortably indeed. But there's so little between the silver medal position of Elia Viviani. It's now 18 points, but he and fifth place Campbell Stewart. And just four between Viviani and Thomas in third place, whilst Matthew Walls has moved up, picked up two more points, 147. Viviani in second place, 122. Thomas, 118. Jan Willem van Skip, 112. And Campbell Stewart, 104.
Well, two more opportunities to pick up points. 19 laps to go, 18 for the leaders.
So, who's going to go big here at the end and try and take a lap as Campbell Stewart and Nicholas Larson and Albert Torres go off the front? Well, it's more and more difficult to take a lap later in the race. Your legs are really, really fatigued.
Yeah, and all the riders of the peloton don't want to let riders go either, so it's very hard to take a lap in the last 20 laps. They are inside now, 16 laps to go.
Yeah, Thomas is driving the chase here for the group as this trio not able to escape. Larson, Torres and Stewart in that lead group. Now, Roger Kluger leads the chase, although it's not too... As I said, they're just keeping them in sight.
Oh, Kluger just drops the wheel there. Three riders with a little bit of gap in the peloton.
Well, Denmark's Nicholas Larsen, his teammate Lasse Norman Hansen in the team pursuit, is the first Olympic champion in the Omnium in London in 2012. Then Elia Viviani in 2016. The format was changed since then. Down to four events in one day as opposed to six in 2 days. Moving away with the timed events.
Well, Stewart, Torres and Larson look like they're going to take the points. Have a sprint here for 5, 3 and 2 points.
Well, Campbell Stewart comes through now.
Yeah.
With Larson and then Torres. So Stewart picks up a couple of points. And he is now just 3 points adrift for the fourth place rider, Jan Willem van Skip. Out of the medals just at the moment is the former world champion, Campbell Stewart. Confirmation of that, Stewart, Larson, and Torres.
Well, they're not giving up in the final 10 laps. Big move coming from Walls of Great Britain and Viviani. They want to catch these riders. Viviani complacent for racing for silver. He's working together with Walls.
Well, yeah, he's only 4 points clear of Thomas. And they know that. Thomas is there. There's Viviani and Walls. Viviani on 122. Walls is well clear at 147. But it's Thomas who's the threat to Viviani's medal, silver medal here.
Well, he's coming across Thomas. He's got the help of the Belgian rider. Viviani working hard, and I think the French rider may have just given up.
So Kenny de Kettler and Elia Viviani have Matthew Walls now just rolled back to sit on the wheel of Elia Viviani.
These are your three leaders at the moment with 5 laps to go.
That's the race lead. Double points with this last sprint, which could, depending on what happens to Benjamin Thomas, vault Campbell Stewart into a medal position.
Well,
he is just 9 points adrift.
These three riders are going to take a lap, which means if they make the catch, then the double points could go to the next three riders. They're going to do, they're going to take the catch for sure.
Well, this will certainly make a difference to Campbell Stewart. This is going to be a big move for the New Zealander. Larson is a little bit further off the pace.
And all the work done by Viviani and Matthew Walls may come to an end.
This is the bell for the final lap here. There, Matthew Walls on the front four. Great Britain is in the gold medal position. He's got himself a superb ride all the way through. Stewart will take the double points at the end as they go round. And Matthew Walls is absolutely superb. 153 points. Campbell Stewart has taken the lap and taken the silver medal for New Zealand. And Elia Viviani is in third place. Confirmation of that final sprint, the double points for Skip. But it is Matthew Walls of Great Britain who is the Olympic champion in the Omnium. Absolutely superb ride by him. Didn't put a foot wrong. And Walls takes it. Campbell Stewart rode brilliantly in the dying moments or dying laps of this race to take the lap and vault himself from fifth to second place. And the New Zealander has taken the silver medal with Elia Viviani, the defending champion, the bronze medal.
Well, two medals to New Zealand tonight. They must be absolutely stoked with that result. Fantastic ride by Matthew Walls. He didn't put a foot wrong during all four races. And Elia Viviani in third takes the Italian flag. And here's your winner, Matthew Walls.
A first gold medal of these games for Great Britain comes on day four. It's been a tough battle for them this year, having been so dominant over the last three or four Olympic Games. But Matthew Walls is the man who puts his name in lights. And Campbell Stewart, tactically very astute, takes second place.
And it came down to that final few laps of the points race for Campbell Stewart. He's getting his hand shaken hard for the defending champion.
Well, a bronze medal is a very fine achievement, but as the Olympic champion, he was hoping to defend. But this man, Matthew Walls, did not put a foot wrong the entire four races. What a fantastic job.
Your Olympic champion in the men's Omnium here at Tokyo, Matthew Walls.
Another Olympic gold medal for Great Britain on the cycling disciplines here. They've really had a fantastic games and could well have more to come.
Well, here you see the moments Matthew Walls had realized he'd become Olympic champion. So much work goes in over the 4 or 5 year period, and to get on the day, to have the legs and to have the being the mentality to go out there and win is not easy. But from race one today until race four, this man, Matthew Walls, was the man in charge.
Confirmation of the result of the men's Omnium. Matthew Walls of Great Britain takes the gold medal, 153 points. Campbell Stewart, a late charge in the points race to take silver. Elia Viviani, the bronze medal. And the world champion outdone in fourth place. Wellsford, Karoliak made the early break to Kettler. Zakharov down to David Maria, who took a couple of points in that points race. And a great achievement for him to finish. But this is the man, the gold medalist, Matthew Walls. There's the silver medalist. And Elia Viviani, the bronze medalist for Italy.
Well, we move straight into the men's sprint again now. It's the race for 5th to 8th place at the Olympic Games. It's a final.
And our field for this 5th to 8th place final, Sebastian Vigier from France, Great Britain's Jason Kenny, Max Levy and Nicholas Paul. What a mix we've got here, because Nicholas Paul, the world's fastest man, thought he'd earned a place in the semi-finals only to be relegated and then lose the third leg. Sebastian Vigier, the young French sprinter, the vastly experienced Max Levy in his 4th Olympic Games. And they don't come much more decorated than this man, Jason Kenny. Twice the sprint champion at the Olympic Games. Fifth place at stake in this four-up men's sprint race. Sebastian Vigier of France, Jason Kenny of Great Britain, Max Levy of Germany, and Nicholas Paul of Trinidad and Tobago.
Well, Kenny takes it out from the front early. 3 laps to go in the sprint. As they come around now, is Vigier on the front. Kenny trying to take the front position. And he's got Levy right on the wheel. A lot of hard work, a long way out for Jason Kenny.
There's the bell. Jason Kenny, Max Levy, Nicholas Paul and Sebastian Vigier.
And Levy comes over the top of Jason Kenny and he's got Paul with him. Can Paul come off the wheel? It's between these two men. It's going to be Levy with all of his experience take the 5th place in the men's sprint in Tokyo. Max Levy, he's happy with that 5th place.
With the Olympic Games in his 4th game, so the German ahead of Nicholas Paul, the 22-year-old, Sebastian Vigier and Jason Kenny. Well, you feel that the fire wasn't quite burning in the belly of Jason Kenny in this race, as much as he gave it all he could. It's just a race too far. So Levy takes 5th place. Will we see him at another Games? This is his 4th. It's only 3 years away. Confirmation of the results for 5th to 8th places in the men's sprint. Max Levy of Germany takes it ahead of Nicholas Paul, Sebastian Vigier and Jason Kenny. Well, a fascinating day of racing here. 2 more medals decided on day 4 of the track program in Tokyo at the Itsu Velodrome, and roughly half the capacity allowed in to enjoy the racing here, and they've been rewarded with some really terrific drama and excitement. So we have 2 victory ceremonies to come, the men's Omnium, but first the women's Kieran here at the Itsu Velodrome.
Mesdames et messieurs, la cérémonie des vainqueurs de cyclisme sur piste, Kaylin Pham.
Ladies and gentlemen, the victory ceremony for the cycling track women's Kaylin.
皆様、ただいまより自転車競技トラック女子Kaylinの表彰式を行います。
So we come to the victory ceremony for the women's Kaylin. And this was a fantastic series of races. It started yesterday.
Please welcome the medalists.
メダリストをお迎えください。
And the three riders who've made their way through the qualifying and then the various rounds to race off for the medals. And Lauriane Jeunesse from Canada, Elise Andrews from New Zealand, and Chano Braspennix from the Netherlands. What a games they are having. Crowd stay to watch the great moment for these athletes to step up onto the podium.
The medals will be presented by
Medal の贈呈は
Monsieur Paul Turgat, membre du CIO Kenya, Olympien, deux médailles d'argent.
IOC member Kenya, Olympian. Two silver medals.
IOC 委員、ケニア、オリンピアン、銀メダル
2。Accompagné par.
Accompanied by.
続きまして。
Dato Amarjit Darshan Singh, membre du comité de gestion de l'UCI, Malaisie.
UCI Management Committee Member, Malaysia.
国際自転車競技連合運営委員、マレーシア。
メダルでブロンズ、カナダ。
ブロンズメダリスト、カナダ。
銅メダリスト、カナダ。
Well, delightful, Lauriane
Jeunesse. Lauriane Jeunesse.
She stands atop the bronze medal podium. Received her medal from one of the legends of distance running, Paul Turgat, a silver medalist in Atlanta and in Sydney in the 10,000 meters. The first Games medal for Canada in cycling at this Tokyo 2020 Games.
Médaille d'argent, Nouvelle-Zélande.
Silver medalist, New Zealand.
Gold medalist, New Zealand.
The toast of New Zealand today. Elise Andrews steps up to collect her silver medal. What a series of races, really aggressive. We'll have to go long from the sprint. And perhaps a new format of the Kaylin suiting the talents and skills of the New Zealander.
Médaille d'or et championne olympique, Pays-Bas.
Gold medalist and Olympic champion, Netherlands.
金メダリスト、オリンピックチャンピオン、オランダ。
Chano Braspennix.
Chano Braspennix, the gold medalist in the women's Kaylin. A very classy ride. And she saw her teammate Lauren van Riesen crash out early in proceedings today. Van Riesen was hoping that she could also be up there, but Braspennix certainly bringing home glory for the Netherlands today, and they've had an excellent time here at the track. Second gold medal. Men's sprint as well.
L'hymne des Pays-Bas.
Ladies and gentlemen, the anthem of Netherlands.
皆様、オランダ国歌の演奏です。
30-year-old Janae Brin-Spannings.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Olympic medalist.
The gold medalist in the women's Kieran. Elise Andrews, the silver medalist, and Lauriane Genest taking bronze for Canada in what has been a wonderful series of races in the women's Kieran. Brin-Spannings, the pinnacle of her racing career. She was a world championship silver medalist in 2015. And last year was fourth in the European Championships. But this is glory like no other. The Olympic gold medal around her neck. Andrews silver. And Canada had two in the final. And Janice making it bronze for the Canadians. Second gold medal at these games at the track for the Dutch, the men's team sprint at the way of the Netherlands. After frustrations in other disciplines in cycling ahead of the track program, they certainly are starting to find their form on the track.
Mesdames et messieurs, la cérémonie des vainqueurs de cyclisme sur piste, Omnium Om.
Ladies and gentlemen, the victory ceremony for the cycling track men's Omnium.
皆様、ただいまより自転車競技トラック男子オムニアムの表彰式を行います。
Final medal ceremony of day four, and it is for the multi-discipline men's Omnium. Four races in one day. A true test of endurance, stamina, and strategy. And it produced a worthy winner because he didn't do anything wrong all day. Matthew Walls marked his rivals and picked up the points when they mattered most. He was the scratch race winner, third in the tempo, second in the elimination, and he marked his rivals very carefully in the points race, but he already had a very handy lead going into that.
Les médailles seront remises par.
The medals will be presented by.
Médaille no zōtei wa.
Monsieur Paul Turgat, membre du CIO Kenya. Olympien, deux médailles d'argent.
IOC member Kenya. Olympian, two silver medals.
IOC Kenya. Olympian,
10,000 meter silver medalist in Atlanta and Sydney.
Accompanied by.
続きまして
Monsieur David Lapartien, President de l'UCI France.
UCI President France.
国際自転車競技連合会長フランス。
UCI President David Lapartien.
Italy.
Bronze medalist, Italy.
Gold medalist.
Well, Elia Viviani is the defending champion. He's a great favourite wherever he goes. But he didn't get off to the best of starts in the scratch race. He pulled it back a little in the tempo and then won the elimination race, but had too much work to do in the points race. But another medal for the likeable Elia Viviani. Add to the gold medal yesterday, the Italian team pursuit quartet in such sensational fashion.
Médaille d'argent, Nouvelle-Zélande.
Silver medalist, New Zealand.
Gold medalist, New Zealand.
Stewart.
Well, what a ride by this man in the points race. He knew exactly what he had to do towards the closing stages, lurking outside the medals in fifth place. He put in an attack to take a lap, the final opportunity he could do that. And the 2019 world champion is now the 2021 Olympic silver medalist, Campbell Stewart from New Zealand.
Gold medalist and Olympic champion, Great Britain.
Team medalist, Olympic.
Well, they'll paint the roads of Oldham gold because this 23-year-old from Oldham has taken the biggest step of his life onto the top step in Tokyo. The gold medalist, Matthew Walls, bronze at the World Championships last year. European champion, but this is certainly the pinnacle of it, and there's more to come, I'm sure.
Mesdames et messieurs, l'hymne de la Grande-Bretagne.
Ladies and gentlemen, the anthem of Great Britain.
皆様、英国国歌の演奏です。
Well, it's often heard at Beijing and London and Rio. We hear the anthem of Great Britain for the first time in Tokyo, thanks to the efforts of the brilliant Matthew Walls in the men's Omnium, as he won the scratch race, was third in the tempo in the elimination race, second, and kept it tied in the points race to take this title and join the ever-growing number of gold medalists from Great Britain. Silver to New Zealand's Campbell Stewart, and Elia Viviani adding the bronze medal to his gold medal from Rio in this remodeled Omnium of four events. High drama and great entertainment it was, and a worthy champion in 23-year-old Matthew Walls from Great Britain.
Today's session. Thank you for being part of the Tokyo 2020 Olympics. Before you go, have a quick look around to make sure you have all your belongings. Have a safe journey home, and thank you for supporting the 2020 Olympic Games.
これにて本日のセッションは終了となります。東京2020オリンピックへのご参加ありがとうございました。お帰りの際にお忘れ物ないようお気をつけてお帰りください。
The Tokyo 2020 Organizing Committee would like to thank all our volunteers for their time and dedication towards making the Olympic Games 2020 such a success. Without your hard work, these amazing games and memories would not be possible.
東京2020組織委員会は東京2020オリンピックにご参加いただいたボランティアの皆様に感謝申し上げます。 皆さんが注いでいただいた時間と思いこそ大会を成功に導いています。皆さんのご尽力があってこそこうした素晴らしい競技や思い出が可能となりました。ありがとうございます。
The conclusion of day four at the track program at ITSU Tokyo 2020. Gold medals so far for China, Germany, the Netherlands, Italy and Great Britain. It's been great drama. We've had six gold medals, six more to come with plenty more action through to the end of the track cycling program at ITSU. You know where to find it. It is riveting entertainment.